listening to the Pagan Centered Podcast, bringing unique and intelligent perspective to the masses using contemporary technology, allowing for free discussion of one's personal beliefs and enlightenment of those not familiar with a particular religion. We bring to the forefront many issues that are ignored or shunned upon by mainstream religion. We discuss topics on a religious and non-religious level as they relate to our panel representing varied belief systems. Our brute honesty and candid opinion has made us one of the longest-running and most popular pagan podcasts. Feel welcome to call in live or submit listener feedback via our website, pagancenteredpodcast.com. And welcome to episode 188 of the PCP, the Pagan Centered Podcast. I'm Dave.
I'm Amber.
I'm Brandon.
I'm Chuck Joe. Paul.
I'm Amanda.
I'm Barrett.
I just fucking good. Keep going.
That was awesome. You should totally use that.
And Miles, if it counts anymore.
Why don't we just poor restart God. That?
Don't think there was a scurvy in there.
Nope.
There was, but there wasn't.
Yeah, Joe and Chuck did it at the same time.
Oh, okay.
I'm sorry.
Yeah, I think I've talked over him there.
Yes, I messed it up. I broke it.
Do we want to redo that?
Yes.
Take two.
Take two, regular host, and then I say something, and then everybody else. All right, so we'll get started in 3, 2, 1. And welcome to episode 188 of PCP, the Pagan Standard Podcast. I'm Dave.
I'm Amber.
I'm Brandon.
I'm Chuck.
I'm Amanda.
I'm Barrett.
I'm Lamika.
I'm Miles.
I'm Star.
I got to go last this time. I'm here.
Tonight we are talking about pagan views on marriage. And we get to that right after these messages. And we're back. So, Chuck did research based off the pagan marriage survey that he did, and we're having him on tonight so that we can discuss the results of that survey, and we can also discuss pagan marriage and stuff.
Sounds good.
Sounds like a plan. All right.
Yeah.
So,
okay.
So Chuck, what was your research about? Like, what were you looking for? Because I'm not really too terribly familiar with the survey itself. I remember taking it. It was like 10 questions, but I wasn't sure what you were looking for.
Yes, well, I'm a marriage and family therapist and also a pagan. And I noticed that a lot of my clients and friends who were pagans were also alternate sexualities, gay, lesbian, bisexual, transgender, et cetera, et cetera. So I was curious as to how we actually define marriage because there's some polyamory going on as well. And I just came up with these 10 questions as kind of a preliminary survey to find out what the pagan perspective is on marriage, to find out how we actually define marriage. I mean, we've got the Defense of Marriage Act that's trying to define it as one man, one woman. And that doesn't seem to be the case in the pagan community, and the survey pretty well backed that up.
I think that's a good plan. I was kind of wondering where we were going with that survey. Yeah. I mean, we got a lot of people here. Some people that have been married, some people that have not yet been married, some people that are getting married, some people that have done marriages. So you got quite the diverse audience tonight. Geez, I just want to do a round robin, even though there's like 15,000 people here. How do we define marriage? let me start this one. This way I can prime the well, per se, and people can agree or disagree or whatever. Basically, I just define marriage as people that are, you know, I mean, usually it's a pair bond that are really not, they're not just sexually attracted to each other. They're not just, oh, we're really good friends. So it's beyond just a physical or a friendship or sexual relationship. It's a couple of people that are just committed to living together for the remainder of their lives. And I don't buy into that whole "so long as the love shall last" kind of crap. Yes, there's definitely circumstances where divorce needs to happen. But that should be an option of last resort, and there should be an element of shame if you have to do that. rather than, oh, okay, well, it's okay. We're going to wash our hands of that and move on. You know, I just think marriage is not just a relationship, but it is an oath. It is an oath before the gods.
Okay. And would you like me to just tell you what the results of the survey were after everybody has had a chance to respond? Or
Yeah, whatever.
Okay. All right. Well, I could tell you now if you'd like.
Everybody's being quiet, so I guess you should.
Yeah.
No. Surprise us.
Okay. Well, the first question was, as a pagan, I personally define marriage as, and there were several options, one man and one woman, which was 3%, two partners of either gender or sex, that was 32%, two partners of either sex or gender, that was 16%, and the biggest answer there, anything two or more consenting adults agree to, that was 49%. So that's pretty much, this was a, let me see how many respondents I had, 1,027 altogether.
Yes. And that doesn't surprise me as much as we've embraced the polyamory community. And I was thinking about that today, that as most of us are polytheists, I would say, of some varying degree, that once you get over the idea of there just being one God to fulfill all your needs, that might play out in your personal life and in your romantic relationships. So yeah. That makes sense to me that would be your result.
Yeah, and the survey, the second part of that, as far as defining marriage, one of the questions was, what are your feelings towards same-sex marriage? And the first question, is it a legal issue? 34% said it was a legal issue. 6.5% said it was a religious issue. 12% said it was a religious and a legal issue. And again, the biggest number, is neither a religious or a legal issue. That was 46.7%, which kind of leaves it, well, if it's neither religious or legal, then what is it? So that would probably be a follow-up question on the next go-around is, okay, if it's not religious and it's not legal, then what does marriage really mean?
Yeah, that does kind of confuse me.
Yeah, that was kind of surprising to me, too. I'm not sure where to go from there.
Yeah, I mean, usually people see marriage as either a contract or, you know, a religious thing, or both. But neither, that's kind of surprising.
Yeah, and I was doing some research on the Brehon Law, the old Irish laws, and there were, I think it was 10 different types of marriage in the old laws. And all of those had to do with property and who gets what if the other one dies and who the heirs are and all that kind of stuff. So back in the old Irish law, it was more of a legal issue than a religious issue. I don't think it became a religious issue until the church became predominant. And I think it was the Council of Trent where they said that you had to have a priest to bless the marriage or it wasn't official, that sort of thing.
You know what I kind of wonder about that is if people are saying it's neither a legal or a religious issue, it's that they are, instead of saying that it's neither of those things, that they're actually just rejecting the idea of an outside authority has control over that.
Yeah, that's kind of what I was wondering too, if maybe it just means, well, it's just a commitment that two people make and the negativity attached with the word religious, I know a lot of my pagan friends don't call their particular paths religious. They prefer to call it spiritual just because of the bad rap that religion has gotten. So that could be just a semantic thing going on there, too.
It could very well be a semantic thing, though. I mean, if you're looking at how so many people in the pagan community are adverse to just first, you know, 20 years ago, 30 years ago, it was being averse to hierarchy and anything related to men having power, even in just the reasonable sense. now it's, okay, no, no, no. We know how to balance it and everything's okay. And I'm okay with that. But now when it comes to marriage, you also have a kind of, I don't want any other outside force, whether it's religion or government or whatever. It's nobody's business but my own. And it's a kind of, I don't know. I look at that as baggage more than anything else, but that's just me.
I think you're right. I think it's that not answering to law or religion means that if person A and person B want to have a committed relationship, their thought is not, okay, who do we answer to? Do we answer to the laws? Or do we answer to the gods? No, they answer to each other and what their heart tells them to do. So their personal commitment, be it two people or three people or four or however many, is that it's not anybody else's business what they do, but the people in the commitment. If they have the blessing of the gods, fine. If they have the blessing of their friends, fine. If they have legal precedent or legal allowance to do so, fine. But us being pagans, we probably look beyond all of that, say, well, the laws which were written for some other people with their viewpoints say it should be that way, but our heart tells us it should be this way. And if our gods, be they of different pantheons or not, if they have an allowance that I'm watching over this person and he's in his relationship and I think he's doing okay, then the people involved are quite happy with that, I should think.
Yeah, that kind of bears up what question 7 said. Question 7 was, whatever happens between two or more consenting adults is their own business and nobody else's. Rate your agreement with this statement, with the above statement. 77% rated totally agree. So I think that might be what's going on there.
To go off of what Miles said, I think he hit the third option on the head. May it be a little bit, Miles put a little bit more complicated, is an emotional thing. It's not a religious, it's not a legal, it's just going off of your emotions.
Yeah, yeah, and that could very well be as well. And that's seven, question 7 would tend to back that up, that it's just how the people feel about each other and nobody else has any say-so in it.
I kind of wonder if there was if like polyamory and same-sex marriage were embraced more by mainstream culture, by the government and by mainstream religions. I wonder if pagans' opinions would change regarding whether or not it's a legal or religious issue.
Yeah, that was actually in my head, so thank you, Star, for saying something. But the other half of what was in my head is that so many of us have heard the phrase the polyamory and same-sex couples were tainting the idea of marriage. Because in a religious sense, it is to procreate, it is, man and woman, and this is the sanctity of marriage, or whatever crap they happen to be spewing at the moment.
Okay.
I'll bite on that for a second. If we're going to do this, we should do this fair.
Okay, I'm taking a chance.
If marriage is only for procreation for those people, then if you're sterile, you can't get married.
Yeah.
Okay. See, like, I'm okay with that.
See, here's the deal.
Some people need to be sterilized.
A certain amount of time, it's nullified, okay?
But that would mean,
if we're going to do it, let's do it right.
Okay, well, so someone actually had this story, and I don't have the link right now. And I apologize because I would like to back that up with the link. But actually, especially in the United States, the only requirement, the whole definition of marriage in the past has been whether or not the couple could enjoy sex together. It didn't matter. Age doesn't matter. sterility doesn't matter. And for a long time, especially in the United States, you were married because you said you were married. Mm-hmm. The whole idea of a marriage license and everything is actually a very new thing. I mean, we've had church records, but the idea of having a legal document is sort of a new thing. So, because there have been cases in the past in the United States regarding people who were mentally disabled, or people who were crippled, people who were sterile, people who were women who were postmenopausal, that sort of thing. And prior to, I would say, the last 50 years or so, the U.S. government has always considered whether or not they are able to enjoy sex as the primary concern as to whether or not they should be allowed to get married. Procreation as the purpose of marriage I'm not going to say that it's not an old idea, but legally it's never been the definition of marriage, at least in the United States.
Yeah, I wasn't referring to United States. I was just referring to some people's views.
Yeah. I know that in a good handful of major world religions, whether it's Christianity, Muslim, so on and so forth, if either one of the partners is infertile or cannot reproduce, that is automatic grounds for a divorce. And it's one of the very few in a lot of religions as to a grounds for divorce.
Well, there's a lot of different reasons for a grounds for divorce. If you're looking at Abrahamic faiths, and one of them is what starts, which is if you're not sexually satisfied, that can also be grounds for divorce.
Yeah.
I mean, the divorce rate is in, you know, a couple hundred, you know, 200 to 400 years ago, the divorce rate was a lot higher, not just in the European societies, but in Asia as well. You know, people would just be like, see ya, move to another town.
Look at Islam. You just got to say, you say something three times, and it could even be over a text message.
I divorce you, I divorce you, I divorce you.
I get a kick out of the fact that you could even do it over a text message. And that is
totally only in legal. Malaysia. Yeah, only in Malaysia. There was a court case of it, and it was only Malaysia. They only ruled that it was allowed because the other partner was not physically within range of the other person.
Oh,
like they couldn't get to that other person. So they ruled it as legal.
Well, that's good context to have because it always sounds silly otherwise.
Yeah. So I just can't get to you, and I have to be divorced in the next 5 minutes. So I'm legally allowed to just text it to you.
I was caught in traffic. No, really.
You know, I mean, it's. I have a lot of friends in Southeast Asia, well, in Asia, and especially in Southeast Asia. And you have to figure it's. People give Islam a very bad rap, but there are many provisions within Islam to protect people and to protect women, to protect spouses. There's a lot in there. So, you know, it does exist. And there are good things and bad things in the different laws that you read about marriage. Whether it's religious base or legal base, so.
Plus the history of marriage. I mean, there's a definite class difference. I mean, if you were a farmhand, your views towards marriage would be different than if you were, for instance, a noble person who had to produce heirs. So most of the most famous, you know, divorce cases that we hear about from history tend to be people who are very famous and very wealthy and from nobility. And of course, those were more high profile, so there was a lot more drug up. If you were a farmhand or you worked in a tavern, you probably wouldn't be held to the same standards as someone who is like the Duke of York or something. But, and also, you know... I had a point. I'll come back to it when I remember it. Sorry.
But that's reflected in the Brehon Law, too. a lot of it has to do with the status of each individual. Like there's one where if the man is a higher social status than the woman, and another one if the woman is a higher social status than the man, and all that kind of stuff about property division, that kind of goes back to that whole class thing.
Mm. Yeah, I remember what I was going to say. So the whole producing heirs thing, also, like, we have more options today. Which to some degree is kind of scary. We've got women waiting till their late 40s to bear children. So we have more options today, and we have more ways to treat infertility. So procreation as a reason for divorce isn't as big a deal nowadays.
Yeah. And one of the things too that was interesting to me is that whole idea of defense of marriage. It comes down, the supporters of that were talking about a biblical view of marriage, and polyamory is condoned in the Bible up until parts of the New Testament. So that was kind of interesting.
I don't know about polyamory, polygamy.
Well, yeah, maybe. Polygamy, yeah.
Polyamory is,
I should probably define what that means too. Yeah, but you're right about that. Polygamy, one man, many wives. Polyamory, either partner, either gender can be multiple partners.
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, but also, well, people say that now. But I mean, if you technically look at the word, you know, polygamy, it just means, you know, spouses, multiple spouses.
Yeah, and yeah.
So I mean, polyamory and polygamy go hand in hand. For pagans, but not for Mormons.
Yeah.
So, you know, and there's a whole bunch of legal stances on everything, and I don't know. I support polygamy, you know, and polyamory, and to be completely fair, if you really wanted to, you can find a way where nowadays we're, you know what, even if your government says that you can't have multiple wives or husbands, or that you're two women or you're two men, and you can find ways in through contracts to override that. It's not going to be easy and it's going to be a hassle, but you can still get it, you know, you can still do it. You know, going back to when we were talking about the legal aspect and the definition of marriage, and who has the final say on it, it still comes back to you. It's just not as easy.
Yeah, that's true. And I think that comes back to equal rights. Why should heterosexual couples have more rights than, say, gay couples or polyamorous, I wouldn't call it couples, but polyamorous groups, whatever, why should they have different rights, or why should they have to go through different legal issues to have the same rights?
Well, actually, let's look at this from a practical standpoint for a moment. Let's say, hypothetically, we got a polyamorous couple, say one man, two women.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Let's say they decide it's not working out. How's the whole property division, kids in custody thing work out?
Yeah.
I don't know, but I bet you can find any lawyer who would love to be paid to figure that out.
Yeah. Yep.
Well, I'm just thinking about it from an employer's perspective. They have to pay for health insurance for spouses, or at the very least offer it. How are they going to pay for that? Yeah, you know, if you're one man, 16, 25, 32 wives, you know?
A lot of... insurance companies now, talking about that, have gone to the thing where you can cover people on your policy and you don't have to identify them as a spouse or anything like that. It's just additional person coverage, and you just write in who you want to cover.
Yeah,
and some people just have family coverage.
Yeah.
I know when we were looking at Brandon's insurance that they didn't say you had to be married. The only thing they said was you could claim a life partner. Sex didn't matter. You just had to claim them as your life partner, not roommate, not anything. It was just somebody that you claimed. This is who I have the relationship with, and I'm not having a relationship with anybody else. This is it. So,
Okay.
That was kind of cool.
And your one life partner or several?
It only went with one.
Hmm.
I think there was weird divisions within it that you could get with children and other people, but that you actually had to get a hold of them and discuss with them.
Yeah.
Let's look at kids for a minute, okay? One man, we'll say three wives, okay? Just let's assume they're all very fertile. You could be looking at like 15 kids there.
That's why they invented the vasectomy, Scurvy.
Yeah.
For you, Scurvy. For you.
Think about this, though. We know.
Well, that's all right, Scurvy. If he doesn't have the money, they could go on WIC and welfare, and it's perfectly fine.
You know, the Mormon community is very concerned about this right now because, you know, traditionally Mormons have always been pushed to have really big families. And then with this, the economic downturn, a lot of Mormon families are struggling. And so there's been a lot of discussion in the Mormon community as to whether or not the doctrine of having large families is actually feasible in this day and age, and if the church is actually pushing people into economic disasters by pushing them to have large families.
I'm so not even going to comment on that, Sar. Except to say, meh.
Well, if the Mormon church wants all these people to have large families, is the Mormon church willing to compensate them for supporting their large families? What's the name of that and one family who have like 19 kids and their names all begin with J?
I know who you're talking about. They have a show on
TLC. None of the John and Kate. Duggars.
There's a reality show for them somewhere, I'm sure.
Yeah.
TLC.
Yeah, 19 and counting.
Yeah, exactly. 19 and counting. And, okay. Started at
16
and counting.
Oh.
Well, when they have a Christmas, who pays for all the various Christmas gifts they give each other?
The television sponsors, of course.
Well, yeah, okay, fine.
Hey, but you know what, though? You got to give some credit to at least the FLDS people, the fundamentalist Mormons, not the crazy ones in the U.S., the ones in Canada. Those guys, they have these huge families, but they also have large plots of land. They grow a lot of their food. They can. They put aside, preserve things. I mean, there are ways of taking care of your family that don't involve going on welfare, and you can still have that large family. It's just we've rendered a lot of our society impotent by taking those things away.
I'm beginning to think that this whole thing against polyamory to a limited extent, but I think the whole, I mean, when you look at the polyamory laws, it's not so much that you love someone that's illegal, it's the fact you're having sex with them that's the problem. And I think I'm beginning to wonder if the polyamory and the anti-polygamy laws exist more for the same reasons the seatbelt laws exist. It's not that we care if you die, you fly out the windshield. It's just that a lot of these people tend not to be of the level of responsibility to be able to clean up their own messes, and thus they wind up getting stuck in all the social nets and dragging out in the whole system.
Well, I mean, let's... down the whole system... I went shopping the other day, so we're gonna traumatize you with some of what I saw. But
okay,
let's assume that you're Joe Cool. You're the coolest kid in school, and you decide you want seven wives. Okay. Next thing you know, you find out about this whole welfare system, and you got your seven wives, which are all cool girls in school. Blessed are. But you got them all knocked up and all that stuff, and you got yourself just a big old baby factory going.
You're an NBA star.
Kelly Mays. But.
Oh, yeah.
But. Now, can we see, which I, I understand. Hey, we got one more person. Now, I understand that this is probably a lot of what's already going on today. But can we see how this can snowball?
Huh?
But and that's, I mean, looking at statistics, you could say that it already has snowballed. I mean, is there really any difference between having several partners at one time and having several partners a couple of years apart from each other and still having kids by all of them either way? Not saying that either way is correct or moral or, you know, especially to the children if you can't provide for all of them. But is it any different than what we already have, I guess, is what I'm saying.
Well, it's just something I sort of want to bring out to hash over. I mean, that's...
I read somewhere, and I do not remember where I read this, that we used to all have large, more agrarian or rural families with the grandparents and the kids and the aunts and the uncles and various people all living under one roof. But following the Great Depression of the 30s and then World War II, I remember they amongst had that they fabricated and invented the idea of a nuclear family, one husband, one wife, one or two kids, so that they could be more economically controlled than large spread out families. So the nuclear family, one husband, one wife, and these kids, was an idea created as a way to keep people in line.
I think that's part of it, but another part of it too is kids are cheaper than farm equipment. And if you've got a 400 acre farm, you have 13 or 14 kids, and you know, give them a knapsack and a hoe and tell them to go out there and weed the garden. Whereas if you had to buy a tractor or 15 mules or whatever it would take, that's not quite as economically feasible as having a bunch of kids.
And just think, right. Just like farm equipment, kids are tax deductible.
You know, that actually helps contribute to the decline of small town agriculture, because with the Industrial Revolution, children didn't stay on the farm; they went to the city. So that combined with the mechanization of farm labor. Was a big factor in that. But if I could just jump back for a second to what Lamika said, one thing about the FLDS in Canada, and this is kind of surprising, Jason at the Wild Hunt's been covering this, is that they are actually, I can't really say they're working, well, I guess they are working with Wiccans, but they are working with polyamorous to try to get the law changed in Canada to decriminalize polygamy.
Yeah.
Which is kind of interesting.
And I think they're doing that in Sweden, too. I'm not sure, but I seem to remember reading that somewhere.
I mean, and this is just me personally. I don't care how somebody gets their naughty bits happy, provided they follow a few caveats, okay? But if you're going to go play with your toys, you need to be responsible. Sometimes poking fun, and she's going to take you serious.
I think sometimes that most Americans have the reasoning and communication skills of a bag of eggplants. So
and that's part of it.
That is not fair to the eggplants.
Just to throw something else on the eggplants,
I'm offended.
I am what I am.
Given that, though, is a marriage certificate going to make them suddenly have reasoning abilities that a piece of paper? Not having a piece of paper. That,
well,
yeah, it's awesome.
And the driver's license make a person a good driver.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, my dad, growing up in rural Georgia, knew a doctor told him one time that he always thought it was absolutely amazing that, you know, there would be a farmer who would go through all of these tests and everything to check the bloodlines and pedigree of a bull before that they would buy it and bring it onto their farm to create more bull cows, that they would go through all of that work, but that
that parents would not actually take the same trouble to check out prospective son-in-laws and daughter-in-laws. because this was back when, you know, they first started, like, blood testing for marriage licenses. And people were kicking up a fuss. And she's like, literally, they spend more time researching the character and quality and pedigree of their farm animals.
Well, I have a theory that instead of having a marriage license, you ought to have a license to have children. That would clear up a lot of this.
Parenting license. I'm okay with that. I think we should employ that immediately.
I agree.
Reality show.
Yeah.
You should have some brains to be allowed to have children. You should have to have some way of taking care of your children before you're allowed to have children.
You have to
take a test and all that good stuff and pass the test before they issue the kid license to you.
And not a multiple choice test.
You know, I agree with that in the spirit that Chuck proposes it, but that could go wrong in so many ways.
Which means...
Ember had an idea way back when that you had two tests. One test to have kids, whether or not, you know, your bloodline, so on and so forth, would be acceptable to have children. And then another test as to whether or not you're able to raise said children. Because there are some people that would make beautiful children and intelligent children, but they should not be raising those kids.
Well, that first test is already illegal as of the past year.
Yeah. Really?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And the problem that I have with making that test illegal is that with personal experience, there are some people who have so many obvious problems in their genetic makeup that you should not be passing that on to your children. So many health issues, and each and every one of them come from the family. It's not like I didn't take care of myself. It's not and they're bad. They're huge things that pass on. And, you know, people don't think of this when they want to have their kids. They just think, well, I want to have my own child. It bothers me that I can't have my own child. And, you know, Nightchild put in the chat room about Gattaca.
Yeah, you know, that's what I was about to say.
I was just thinking that, too.
What it sounds like, yeah.
You know, so I understand that there's a problem with going too far. So I'm not saying that we need to test everybody, and but there's a point where some people just should not reproduce just because of the obvious problems to it.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, to riff off of that for just a second, I find this interesting. The chance for genetic abnormalities in your child are higher if you decide to have a child over the age of 40, or if you decide to have if you have in vitro fertilization. It just that's just how it is. Those rates, though. The possibility that your child would have genetic issues if you had a child over the age of 40 or if you had a child via in vitro fertilization are actually higher than if you had a child as a product of incest. I'm not advocating that. I just find that an interesting trivia fact. So when these women decide that they absolutely need to have a biological child and they're 48, I get a little irritated.
And it's actually...
Go ahead, Chuck.
I was just going to say, last time I looked at this, I haven't checked it recently, but about 5 or 6 years ago, it was still legal in 13 states to marry your first cousin.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I think about 12 of those were in the South. So.
It's more than you think.
I think the other one was Pennsylvania.
Yeah.
That explains a lot.
Second cousin, Dave.
Oh, they moved up in the world.
No, I will say this, that I have talked to my sisters about this and that we find this extremely strange, but our cousins were really, really cute. If they had not been our cousins, they might have been in trouble.
But I mean, what's funny about the statistics is my mother had my youngest sister when she was in her 40s, and she has considerably less issues than I do from the genes. So.
Yeah, kids really are, though, just sort of a crapshoot. You just, they're like a box of chocolates. You never know what you're going to get.
But I mean, sometimes it is pretty obvious. So I'm not talking about like, oh, well, there's cancer that runs in the family. Maybe we should reconsider. Oh, well, there's, you know, your great aunt Agnes had this strange disorder. This is like everything that I have is blatantly obvious. And somebody should have said, this is not a good idea. They will get at least something from this horrible mess, and it's not good.
And you get into those things where there's like genetically inheritable diseases too that are fatal and things like that. Should those people be allowed to have children knowing that the child is probably not going to survive to adulthood? So it's kind of a shaky ground to say, okay, we're going to say that you can't have any tests at all to get married, but you know, on the other hand, you've got the other issue going on. So
now, not all things are guaranteed to pass on, eh? I'll tell you, it's no secret that my genetics should say I'm really screwed up, and if we had this testing, I might not be here. But I've beaten every single one of those odds, and any of you, Amber, Dave, you might know. I'm not supposed to be able to use sarcasm. So, for any, Amber and Dave, you might remember, I'm a little sarcastic by nature. So,
no.
Exactly. So, I just, in defense of those people, yes, that's testing might be great and that might be helpful, but it's not a guarantee.
Yeah.
You know, that's a very good point, because the mortality rate is lower and the infant mortality rate is lower. I technically, you know, had I been born like 100 years ago, I would have died before I was 12 because I was born with a birth defect. But modern science means that I'm here and I'm coughing all over your podcast. So the need to have as many children as possible and let the strongest survive is also not really necessary nowadays. You don't need to have like 10 kids and hope that you have 3 living adult children.
Well, but we've just moved on to another stage of, you know, letting the strongest physically survive. Now it's like people want to go to the mental, you know, the next step beyond mental, where it's like, how can I make the best, most well-rounded, awesome Uber baby, you know? And with regards to even that kind of testing, we don't know enough about genetics to even be honestly serious about doing any kind of a test. I mean, how do we know that, you know, by removing let's say Down syndrome from the genetic code in order to quote unquote save a child and all children from now on doesn't end up screwing us over, you know, 50 to 100 years down the line, because somewhere within that code was wrapped up the cure for the next big problem that's going to face us. So,
yeah,
you know, there was something earlier that I had wanted to say, but I forgot. When it comes to licensing, it's not surprising that the Canadian FLDS and Wiccans and polyamorous are working together to legalize polygamy. It's not surprising because it's not about recognition per se when it comes to these two groups. It's about the fact that your taxes are affected by it, your insurance, your health care. And on top of that, I mean, if one of your wives or your husbands gets sick, and if you're not able to say, hey, that's my wife or that's my husband, you know, you can't go visit them. Even if that person is on their deathbed, the hospital is not allowed to let you into that room because you're quote unquote not next of kin or a spouse. So the legal aspect is why we're all working hard to make it possible, because it's the same reasons as to why is the LGBT community championing for I can't say that correctly.
Championing. Shit.
Championing. I don't know why. I'm having a weird day. Anyways, they're working really hard for it as well. It's not necessarily because they want recognition. Some do, but a lot of them also want to have the abilities that, if you think about it, you know, lesbians and lesbian couples and gay couples couldn't have in you know, the 60s and 70s when their partner is dying or their partner is hurt or their partner passes away and, you know, everything was in their partner's name. And so now all of their property, everything they have goes to that, their partner's next of kin, and they have nothing, you know, and they might, so it's about the legal aspect, the licensing, not necessarily just the religious or standing up for equal rights. It's also the practical.
I think one thing that's getting overlooked in this conversation is that a lot of people have the perception of, let's face it, I think the TLC show that, what is that, Sister Wives?
Yeah. I think smug.
That
I cannot
is the
stand
mindset
him.
Most people have about polygamy, is that it is one guy with multiple females, and it's always the guy that's, let's face it, it's a slightly abusive situation.
In some ways, yeah.
It doesn't have to be, though.
No.
Yeah, it doesn't have to be.
Yeah, and that's where you get into the whole thing about, you know, polygamy versus polyamorous relationships. It's just it's been associated so long with one guy and multiple wives that people don't know about the other, or people know about them, but they don't really consider the other aspects, you know, having multiple partners of both genders. And
well, I see polygamy as more of the marriage and polyamory as the pre-marriage, you know, when you're courting.
Yeah.
You know,
it's just that,
you know, people have not, the people that are functional polyamorous and eventually polygamous units, you know, they generally don't out themselves. They are successful. They really don't want the government chasing after them. So they kind of keep it on the down low.
Well, if you outlaw polygamy, then the only people practicing polygamy are outlaws. But actually, a really good sort of exploration of functional polygamy, I'm completely hooked on the show because I love anything with lots of drama, is Big Love. Big Love's really interesting because it really explores the whole idea of polygamy in a non-affiliated Mormon setting. It's a family. They're not member of the LDS Church, and they're no longer with an FLDS branch off or extremist group. So they're just sort of exploring that on their own. And it's an interesting show. It's full of drama. I love it. But, two things. First I want to touch on something Lamika said. You know, the whole idea of, like, screening your partner for, like, mental defects, you know, or mental illness or something like that is, you know, if we were to do that, we would all become very, very dumb. Most of the geniuses in the world have all had some sort of mental quirk or mental problem that today they would be highly medicated for. It's the whole idea of depression and melancholy as being part of creativity is something that scientists are seriously exploring now. A big case is Beethoven. He became extremely depressed when he lost his hearing, but he wrote some of his greatest music after he was deaf while he was in the middle of his depression. And another thing we haven't touched on is, you know, we're in the middle of an economic slump, and weddings are expensive. If same-sex weddings were legalized, and if polyamorous or if polygamy was legalized, that actually means more weddings. And weddings are expensive. That means more money in the economy, people spending money to do this. And they've actually done studies. They've actually wondered if same-sex marriage could actually save the California economy.
Yeah, I've seen that.
I've
seen studies about that. That's kind of interesting, but and more divorces too. So the lawyers would have lots of money coming in.
It's like, you know, it's one of those things, though, where you go, why is there even a study about this? This seems like common frickin' sense.
Yeah.
You know, I mean,
common sense is not so common.
Exactly. I know, but still, there are certain ones that are just like, you need to be punched in the face if you can't figure that out.
But, well, hey, grad students need stuff to write about, you know. We all have to have a dissertation or two.
Some of us just need content every day.
Yeah.
Yep.
But that whole thing about testing. Oh, go ahead.
Here's something else I'm toying around with. Let's say, hypothetically, polyamory became legalized tonight. How many loopholes are in the law right now that could be exploited?
Yeah.
And that's the reason lawyers would make money, which would in turn help our economy. Because then all these people who went to law school will actually have jobs when they get out of college.
No.
I think my problem with the polyamory getting legalized isn't with polyamory itself, because that can be a beautiful idea and it can work. My problem isn't with the people that it works with. My problem is going back to the fact of most people have the common sense of a bag of eggplants and can't keep a normal relationship running. They don't understand what a relationship is, let alone a relationship with other people. I don't believe our society is something that can accept polyamory right now. We can hardly look at same-sex couples and go, yes, this, what's wrong with us? We should accept this. We should have moved on past this. We can't accept that, let alone as a whole, same-sex right now, or polyamory right now. We're trying to run before we're even out of the womb.
I've looked at several studies on polyamorous relationships, and overall they rate the quality of their relationships as better. One had it almost 25-30% better than just a regular heterosexual marriage.
Mm-hmm.
So people who are polyamorous are able to have better relationships than plain old couples, according to the research.
Yeah, but at the same time, this is something that is considered, you know, it's like it's the same argument for bringing back the old witchcraft laws. You know, when something is illegal, fewer people do it. And it seems like a few people that are into polyamory, and I've been in a polyamorous relationship, you know, one female, multiple males. And, you know, it was one of the better relationships I've had. And but at the same time, I think it takes a certain person with an astounding level of maturity to go ahead and be able to handle it. I mean, some people just aren't built. I'm not wired to love multiple females. That's just not how I'm wired.
But, and that's probably why the results came out that way, because you have to be kind of pretty sure of yourself and have your insecurities pretty well nailed down before you would even consider doing something like that. So that's probably the results are probably a little skewed because of that.
You know, to play devil's advocate, though, I mean, our divorce rate is something outrageous. It's like 50%. So to say that, you know, being polyamorous takes a lot of maturity and communication and respect is no different than you know, quote unquote, normal relationships taking a lot of maturity and communication and respect. Every relationship takes a lot of work, whether it's with multiple people or single people. And the fact is that a lot of people can't handle a single relationship.
But you know what I think it is? I think the thing is like, I remember my poly relationship was the first one where I wasn't being micromanaged in a romantic relationship. You know, I can go out and hang out with, you know, I can hang out with Ashley doing podcasting, and that there was just no questions about that. You know, whereas when you get a one-on-one relationship, it's very much, you know, there's a much more greater tendency for freaking out at every little thing.
Well, I think that the freaking out on every little thing depends on the individual. Yeah. But the reason that polyamorous relationships are happier is that you are forced to be more honest. there are more people involved, you get caught at sneaking around much quicker, and you have to face it. It's not so much a two-person argument. You now have several middle people involved that you're not allowed to run and hide from your problems anymore. So yes, it does take a more mature person, without question.
Yeah, but I have a theory about... Oh, go ahead.
Go ahead, go ahead.
I was just going to say, my theory about it is, you have a heterosexual couple here, and 60% chance that the man is going to cheat, and somewhere about the same, little bit less with women, that they're going to cheat as well. So basically, it's already a polyamorous relationship. It's just that they're lying to each other and cheating each other and not saying that it is. But if you have an actual true polyamorous relationship, everybody's honest about who's sleeping with who, that element is gone. So there's not so much deception going on.
But to reduce polyamory to I get to sleep with multiple people is not what polyamory is, and that's not what marriage is, you know, polygamy or otherwise. I mean, that's another huge issue with this, is that, like Amber and Sarah and many people have said so far, you know, you have to have a level of maturity that, whether it's with one person or multiple people, you've got to have your shit together.
Exactly, and yeah.
People don't, and people can go their entire lives without having their shit together.
Yeah, and I actually think...
You know, is that my fault? No, that's your fault. So don't, you know, and put these legal impediments in front of me because you're an ass. I don't know, just me.
And that would be a good question that's for somebody to study, and there might be a study already on it, is do people do better in polyamorous relationships because there's not that element going on as far as the exclusivity? Does that make sense?
I actually wonder if it's not that a one man and one woman marriage is takes less work or requires less mature people than a polyamorous relationship, as much as it is that's simply the norm, and so we've come to think that anything beyond what we have come to call normal requires a different grasp of this situation than just being one and one. And so it's not that much different, really, I think. You just have to broaden your mind view to, okay, this is my normal, and this works for me. We've been programmed, I think, into thinking that one and one is a normal marriage, but I think that harems are an example of what we have come to think of as abnormal marriage, but they work well for everyone involved. And with the question of if it's a one and one, are you under worse scrutiny or is it more stressful as a relationship? I think that a polyamorous is less stressful because if, let's say, the husband and wife number three have a fight, then husband can go and console wife number one while wife number two spends time talking to wife number three to help work out what went wrong. So the third or fourth partner becomes the bartender, because you can tell your bartender things you can't tell your wife.
Yeah. But
you have a good point, though. You really do. I mean, it within polyamory is a better, in my opinion, a better structure. You know, I mean... And it's not just when it comes to conflicts. You have more people to, you know, some people say, well, you have more opinions flying around, it can get worse, but you have more people to help resolve it as well. And on top of that, if you get hurt or if your partner gets hurt, there are other partners, there are other spouses within there that can help to make sure everything is still okay. You know, I mean, financially, financially, emotionally, physically, I don't know. It makes more sense to me.
It's more of a village structure instead of it being two people all
scorched
alone.
Earth.
It's more of a village structure where you have multiple forms of support and no one feels like they have to carry the load of not just their own things but another person, which can sometimes happen in one-on-one marriages where you feel either that someone needs to be your be-all and end-all or you feel like you need to be the be-all and end-all for a single person, which can be intimidating and stressful and hurt the marriage.
But is, I mean, one thing I wanted to bring up, and I'm not even sure what the answer is to this, but are pagans clinging to polyamory because of lack of family units, you know? Usually pagans either disown their families or their families disown them shortly after they come out as being pagan. And, we're human. We like having family units. We like that village structure. Or are we just subliminally pursuing polyamory as to fill that void?
Honestly, well, I think most people don't have a firm grip in reality. So they see things that aren't the normal, so they drift towards them. Not everybody. So I'm not in any way saying that that's the everybody who views that. But, I mean, pagans in general, there's a lot of them that will say, well, I'm not having a priest because I don't like the idea of them calling priests. I don't like the idea of clergy because it reminds them of Catholicism. Well, I'm breaking away from everything of the Abrahamic faiths, so I'm going to have polyamorous relationships and you have to be okay with it. So I think sometimes they just fantasize about it and glorify it.
Yeah. That's with angry defensiveness, that is. I actually think that now the question of do pagans embrace polyamory more because it's a rebellion against the norm, I think that's not quite the case so much as pagans, being primarily, I think, polytheistic, have an openness with multiple deities. Would they also stretch that to embrace an openness with multiple spouses?
Yeah,
I'm also reminded, I have one anecdote here, that at a pagan festival years and years ago, I met a husband and the wife and the wife and the wife of a polyamorous quad. And one of the people in the cabin with all of them was a girl who was about 4 years old, who was the daughter of one of the wives, was conceived before she joined into the quad. But the girl said that she has a daddy and a mommy and a mommy and a mommy, and she said he's in a in a Tully Mama Us family.
You know, I kind That's of agree adorable. With that. I agree with that. There's the feeling that if you're in a monotheistic religion, and I encountered this as a teenager, as a Christian teenager, that you're only really dealing essentially with one God, and like all of your needs, your religious needs, have to be fulfilled by that one God. And then as you come into paganism and polytheism, you find that you're developing relationships with different gods and that your relationship is different with each god. And each god that you end up working with gives you something different that you need. And so the whole, our whole cosmology, our whole theology for the most part, sort of ingrains in us as we become settled into pagan modes of thought and worship and practice that, you know, you're not going to find everything in one person. And so I think the reason polyamory is so popular among pagans is because in a way it's our sort of mimicking our spiritual lives in our mundane lives.
And if you go back and read Celtic mythology, everybody was sleeping with everybody, you know, even back then. So that kind of reflects the whole polytheistic approach to things. But there's a book by Dr. David Barash called The Myth of Monogamy, and he talks about this whole idea of the one man, one woman marriage. Right now, think of all the people you know who are married, and any of them that have been married over 10 years that have never had an affair and never had another sexual partner besides their spouse. How many of them can you name? That what he's saying there is that we have this myth that there is monogamous relationships out there, but in reality, they're so rare as to be almost non-existent. And we're actually living already in a polyamorous society, but we just don't want to acknowledge that because of the Judeo-Christian template that we view society through.
You know, and something that I've noticed in people in my life, and the people who tend to emphasize more on monogamy as being extremely important to them, usually tend to be in relationships where they end up being unfaithful to their partner.
Yeah.
And I'm not saying that that's everybody who emphasizes monogamy, but I have noticed that as a pattern, whether regardless of religion. I had a friend who was very dear to me. I was friends with her and her husband, and she made the mistake of letting me know that she was fooling around with his best friend, I guess because, you know, I'm pagan and therefore I approve of lying. So it caused a huge moral dilemma for me. I didn't care that she was, you know, getting a little extra, but, you know, the fact that she was lying to her husband, who was also my friend, blew me away. And she was a Sunday school teacher, and that that blew my mind.
Mm. Well,
the way I see it is we're over complicating this. Humanity has very, very to the point ideas and needs, and it goes in the way. There's the ooh shiny idea, and that happens with a lot of cheating. That's something new. That's something beautiful, and they sleep with it. Or we need a village. We need that community, and we broke it when we became the atomic families or whatever.
Nuclear family.
Yeah. Nuclear atomic. Yeah.
Nuclear family.
Radioactive family.
Yeah.
That's what I was thinking. Anyways, it's not religion. It's not fighting the laws. It's just we want
people.
We want people around us. We want lots of love. And it just works better. Period.
And that comes down to how you define polyamory. I mean, is it just about sex, or is it also about love? I mean, I don't love everybody I've ever had sex with, and I don't have sex with everybody I love. So is how much of the sexual element is in there?
Well, I think that's why people, you know, stepped up and called it polyamory, because they wanted even the very word itself to contain a more love. You know, that these are very serious relationships. This is not something you take on as a, you know, we do have, in English, you do have the other words for that. Somebody who has, you know, multiple partners, they call them open relationships, or they say they're swingers, or there are other words, you know. And so why not, when it comes to the marriage issue, why can't we, instead of doing the, in my opinion, damn silly debate over religion and the law, do what, like you were saying, with older forms of law, make it under certain degrees, you know? I mean, there are some people who don't want something called a marriage because they associate it, you guys probably know Torchwood, you know, John Barrowman, who's, he plays Captain Jack on the show, and he went out and he got a civil union, and he said, he looked right into the camera and he's like, I don't want a marriage because I don't want something that is, what did he say? I don't want a marriage because I don't want something that's from a religion that hates me or something like that, because he associates the word marriage itself with Christianity, and which is a shame because it's just a word,
you know, but to go back into the idea of polyamory being about love and not sex, I know a polyamorous triad. I'm not going to name them or anything, but it's a man who has two female partners, and I've met them and I'm friends with them, and they're lovely people. And the thing that impresses me most about it is that the women each individually have relationships with the man. To my knowledge, the women are not bisexual, but these women love each other. They support each other. They go on vacations together. They they do things together. They have family dinners together. They both have kids, and so they do things with their kids together. So, they're sort of they're in this polyamorous relationship. There is love between them, but there's not sex. And I find that both fascinating, and I find that inspiring, to see a relationship like that works so beautifully.
Yeah, and that's where the whole thing with the sex comes up. The first thing that people think about with polyamory is sex, but it's not necessarily about just sex. It could be the love element. I've known platonic polyamorous groups, so it's just a question of I feel this way about you, we just don't have sex.
I think it sort of goes back to the whole idea of marriage, and I know that a lot of religions go back to the sex-based thing, but I know for me personally it's no longer a idea of having a sexual relationship with somebody else, but it is a commitment of you are no longer living for yourself, but you are making a commitment to somebody else saying, you are my family. You are part of my life. You actually share a life. So you're no longer living for yourself, and they are no longer living for themselves. But you are living for each other, to support each other, whether it is financially, physically, mentally, emotionally. You are there for each other, and whether or not what you want in life, you may have to give up some of that in order to have that relationship. And yeah. I think that goes... That is the heart of what marriage is, and it's not necessary, or what it's supposed to be is for the rest of your life, is, you are stating that you are my family, and family is, a lifelong thing. It's something that you cannot change. It is your blood. And I think that's where a lot of the failed marriages and stuff that I see is, you've decided to take that person on for rest of your life, and now, because of one instance or another, you say that you can't do that. I mean, it's sort of like saying, you're my mother, but now you're no longer my mother. It's sort of disowning that person from your family.
You know, Brandon, you make a good point about the family thing, because yeah. That's something else that pagans do is, like Dave said, that, a lot of times we have issues with our biological families. And so we have a tendency to create family. And maybe that's one reason we're more open to polyamory, because we're already used to creating family and inviting people in as our family and treating people as family who aren't biologically related to us. That could possibly translate into being more open towards ideas like polyamory.
Yeah, Richard Bach has a great quote. He says that members of the same family very rarely grow up under the same roof, and that whole idea of brotherhood and sisterhood in the pagan community, you know, that becomes your family if you get rejected by your own family for coming out of the broom closet, that sort of thing. And I think that can translate into the polyamory thing, too.
It occurs to me as well is the reason I think I would not do so well in a polyamorous relationship with multiple partners is that sometimes I just need my alone time, and if I only have one partner, then I only have to find my alone time from one person. If I have 2, 3, 4 partners, then I have to divide my time even further and be alone. My alone time away from all of them would be less and less and less because everyone shares each other's time. And a side thought to that, of course, is that would a requirement of being in a successful polyamorous relationship be that a person has to be less selfish or self-oriented?
You should be a good time manager.
My only recommendation for this is make sure you have a very good bathroom.
Yeah, a very big one. Well, what I was thinking about when you were saying that is, if you need some alone time, you could look at your other partners and say, hey, could you guys keep each other busy? I'm going to go off in the woods for a while.
Time management.
Yeah,
that's true.
It's like if you have a stressful job. Sorry.
I do know people who have been in polyamorous relationships, and that's kind of one thing that they did say was kind of true, that even though you want your alone time sometimes for the benefit of everybody else, that you give up your alone time because it's everybody, the more that you deal with more people, the more that you sometimes have to give up. Now, the benefit of that is sometimes there are other people willing to take over. So you have a wider variety of people who are capable of handling a problem better than you. But yes, that they have all agreed that it seems to be that you have to be less self-oriented the more people that you have.
You know, I find it fascinating that, you know, this is a pagan podcast and we're talking about pagan views on marriage. And we haven't discussed hand fasting or the idea of trial marriage yet.
Yeah.
It's a good hand idea. or two faiths coming together.
Oh, God.
Well, hand fasting sounds more like what the results we were getting on the survey here about it's neither a religious or a legal issue. Hand fasting, the original intent there, when there weren't enough priests to go around to make sure that everybody was married, you would just hand fast, you know, shake hands and come together and say, okay, I'm committing myself to you. Do you commit yourself to me? Yes, I do. And that's all that was needed. There was no legal contract, no sanction from the church or anything like that. It was just two people agreeing to commit themselves to each other.
Oh, hand fasting is a handshake wedding then.
Well, that's
yeah.
Technically, yeah.
So that's basically you look them in the eye and you shake hands and you give them your word.
Yeah.
When it's over, you text them 3 times and you're done.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
And then you do the hokey pokey and yeah.
Is that before or after the texting?
That's after the texting. You have to text everybody doing the hokey pokey and where and when.
Yeah, exactly.
And then you post it on YouTube.
Yeah.
I mean, I just take hand fasting as a very serious religious ritual. I just don't understand how that's done in a polygamous hand fasting. I just don't understand how that is done, how that ritual is done.
Really?
With a lot of
rope. No, it's easy.
I was actually at the one at PSG, and it was really, really beautiful. Each person committed to the other partner, so it was actually a triad,
And so each person stood up and they committed themselves to the other two people in their relationship, and it was really beautiful.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Well, that's
a and the hand fasting ritual, one part of the performance is that their hands are physically tied together. If it's multiple people, then they all get their hands tied together like spokes on a wheel. Mm-hmm. And they help each other roll that way.
You just need more rope.
You just need more rope. That's right.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
You always need more rope.
I'd fancy your knots.
And if you give them enough rope, they'll hang themselves. Yeah.
Hang fasting. There you are. Yeah. That's putting your neck out.
I think that involves Kool-Aid.
Yeah.
Oh, bad.
Flavor Aid. Woo! Get a historically accurate Flavor Aid.
Flavor Aid.
Well, they couldn't even get the expensive stuff.
Okay, so we did hand fasting. What about a trial marriage? Like, where does that fit into this whole mess?
Like a year and a day type thing?
Yeah.
I once heard that a hand fasting, this is probably woefully inaccurate, and I can be corrected if this is wrong, is that a hand fasting was a trial union between members of two clans to see if the clans are compatible, and they hand fast for a year and a day, and then if it turns out that the couple is not compatible, like they couldn't have kids, then that means that the clans would not be compatible, and so the two would just shake hands and go, okay, well, we tried, but it didn't work. That's fine. And so a modern hand fasting in that aspect is a trial marriage in which it is understood that it's like a probationary marriage for a year and a day, and then if after that time you decide, I gave this one a test drive and it didn't work out like we'd try, we fought too much, we had differences, whichever it is, and then there's no harm in annulling the hand fasting, and everyone agrees that they're okay with that.
You know, I have to say that if you have to get pregnant within a year, that's an awful lot of pressure. That's a lot of performance issues in the bedroom. I'm glad that that's not a tradition anymore.
Well, I mean, that is kind of my view on hand fasting, with exception of the, oh my God, we got to get pregnant thing.
Yeah.
But I would definitely say, you know, because I mean, I see so many people now in my family, outside my family. I mean, they're getting married. They barely know each other. They haven't even lived together for like more than a grand total of like 2 weeks. And now they're getting married to buy a house, and it's like, really? You guys haven't lived together for any significant period of time?
It's a tax dodge.
Pretty much.
That's why you marry. It's a tax dodge.
Yeah.
Well, I've heard several different versions of that, and the one that I kind of like that I've heard was that, you know, going back to every marriage had to be blessed by a priest, and there weren't enough priests to go around. So they would do a hand fasting and wait for the priest to come into town. And if they were still talking to each other by the time the priest got there, then they would make it official.
Well, that's fair.
I like that.
Well, but there's also the element of clergy, right? I mean, there are a lot of priests, priestesses, whichever faith path, you know, who will not, pagan included, who will not marry you if they feel that you two are not right for each other. You know, I can think of two offhand right now that, you know,
I've had to make that call as well.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And sometimes I think that's really good. Brandon and I had a couple that, you know, they went to us and, you know, would you officiate the marriage? And we said, hell no.
Not you two crazies.
And, you know, it was valid reasons. It wasn't like, oh, well, I just think you're crazy and I just don't like you. It was, looking at them, you could see that there was no communication, there was no mutual respect, and they should just wait a while, if nothing else. So it's, yeah, the Nightchild just put in, you know, the concept of pre-marriage counseling. And I know that there seems to be a lot of pagan people who don't like the idea that some of them will count for counseling. Like, well, if you go to us for hand fasting or marriage or whatever you choose to call the ceremony, we require that you have a counseling session. And they're like, no, we just want to get married.
Yeah, you know, I require three when I do a hand fasting or a wedding. I require at least three.
You know, that's interesting. It's not just pagans who are concerned about that. I mean, other religions are concerned about that, and it goes back a good ways. When my grandparents decided to get married right after World War II, I don't know that she was pregnant, but let's just say they ran off in a hurry to get married, and they went through about three or four ministers who absolutely refused to marry them because they had decided to elope. And the only way they actually ended up getting married is they ran across a minister trying to patch his roof. And my grandfather literally patched his roof for him in order to get married. Wow.
That's great.
Now, of course, if there's nobody who will approve them and will wed them, all they have to do is go online and download their ULC ordination and do it themselves. Bing, we're done.
Yeah.
Well, you know, back when I got married, our minister, his mother was very sick, and he couldn't guarantee that he'd actually be at our wedding. So we actually, that morning, just to be on the safe side, we just went down to the Justice Department and Justice of the Peace, and he gave us the minimum. And then we went on about our wedding preparations and everything and had our spiritual ceremony that evening. So, I mean, it was, you know, $30 and less than 30 minutes to legally get married. It really wasn't that big a deal. It was actually scary at how fast that happened, not looking back.
Yeah.
$30, 30 minutes or less, guaranteed. Get married at Justice of the Peace. Downtown.
In the Elvis Temple.
I think we've got it backwards, because it costs about $30 to get into a marriage and about $50,000 to get out of one. So the other way around.
I can tell you that my entire marriage, the license to get married, and I dripped my own paperwork and filed it myself, my entire marriage legally, just legal fees, cost me $112.50.
Okay. That is completely backwards. You should be able to get out of it a lot easier than get into it.
I don't know. I really think that if you make the commitment to wed, and if you are willing to make the commitment to stick it out through the hard times and the tough times and all of that, and deal with each other's impression and anger and mood swings and dirty laundry and things, if you're willing to go through all of that, then you should be willing to stick it out to the bitter end. Because it's been observed that every marriage in the world that has ever been performed will end in exactly one of two ways, death or divorce.
But what about those people that they get married, they think their partner is all fine and dandy, but then something happens where their partner is abusive, or their partner is this, that, and the other. They're not who they married, per se, because of something that happens, they completely change. And you're right. I personally agree with you that a marriage should be till you're dead. But in the same
breath.
Hopefully
not too soon.
Yeah, right?
Although I have to wonder as well, that's a phrase I use a lot, by the way, about one couple that I knew for a while, and they got married, and then he found out that he used to be a he and never told him.
Ooh.
That had a sex change operation before they even met. They got married, he was all happy, then he found out that she used to be a guy, and after that, he couldn't even look her in the eye anymore. We as pagans might not take that as harshly as they do, because this person was just trying to find his sexual identity, her sexual identity, and we'd be cool with that. But the man in question was oh so very much not cool with that, he went down to get a divorce the very next day.
But you know what? It's not so much that I wouldn't be cool with it. Like, if I all of a sudden found out Brandon was used to be female, and then, you know, after we got married, he's like, oh, by the way, you know, I used to be female. It wouldn't bother me of the fact of the sex change. What would bother me in that case and why I might consider, you know, separating was, why couldn't you tell me this before we were married? We're supposed to be open and honest with each other. This is a big deal and you can't tell me this. What about all the little things that you can't tell me? So yeah. That's where...
Honesty.
Yes.
Well, you know, and that's a big deal too. And also, people I think also have a tendency to go into marriage thinking that they can change people. I do know someone who married someone knowing that they were a cross-dresser and this was a smart person. And they looked it up and they found that people who do this, they don't change. This is who they are, and that's how they're going to be for the rest of their life. It's not like something you can go through counseling for, generally. So they were not okay with that, but they trusted when the person said that they had changed for them. And, of course, the person couldn't change. That was still part of who they were. And then the person sort of acted all hurt and upset when, you know, they discovered that their underwear was missing. So, you know... The idea that you go into marriage to change people too is definitely a major factor going into divorce. And that's not being dishonest with the other person as much as it is being dishonest with yourself.
And I think that's some of that true. Has... Go ahead, Chuck.
I was just saying that's very true that that's the first rule. When I counsel couples, I tell them the first rule is you can't change anybody but yourself. The second rule is see rule number one. Because I can't tell you how many relationships, marriages, couples, et cetera, that I've seen where, he won't change the way I want him to, or she won't change the way I want her to. Guess what? You're stuck with that. You can't change anything but how you react to it.
And I think that's something with the society that we, in general, kind of have this, but this is how I want it. And because I want it, I should have it now. And I think that you would be a better person if you didn't do this. So therefore, you shouldn't do that because I said so. And that's the way it should be. So
relationships are not Burger King.
Entitlement issues. Entitlement issues.
Yeah.
You know, so exactly. I've seen so many couples who have long-term or consider themselves long-term, or they decide to get married, and then the first time that they have an argument or a disagreement, I don't know if I can do this. I can't. It's so hard. They won't bend in. And it's like, would you stuff your self-entitlement somewhere and maybe listen to what they're saying for just a minute? You're the one that said that you're married. Fix the problem and don't go, oh, well, it's too hard. I'm going to go get a divorce now.
On the flip side of the coin, people do change after they get married. Absolutely. You know, I half-assed a woman I loved, and after she got pregnant by some other guy, not once, not twice, but three times, I had to seriously stop and think, this probably isn't working out.
Well, yeah, there's definitely situations like that. Like, I'm hoping my middle sister gets a divorce because I like my brother-in-law. So,
I mean, it took me a second.
Would you like to schedule an appointment?
No, my brother-in-law is a really nice person. My sister, however, is not. So I would like to see him not suffer so much. So there definitely are situations where, guys, this isn't working. Drop it already.
Yeah, and that goes back to what Dave was saying. They don't call it the honeymoon period for nothing. Everybody's on their best behavior when they first start dating or first start a relationship. You know, you don't let them see you with your hair in curlers. You don't let them see you walking around in your boxer shorts, scratching your rear end, you know, that kind of thing. And after about a year or so, you kind of lose the energy to keep up that best foot forward type thing. And then that's when all the second thoughts start showing up.
It's also the opposite that is true, you know. Some people can go in exactly who they are, and it's their partner who is not, I guess, you know, honest with the reality of that situation. You know, a very extreme example would be, you know, you end up in a relationship with some druggie. They have an addiction. It's obvious. You knew about it beforehand, and some people just never leave that cycle. You know, I mean, that's a crazy, you know, extreme example, but, you know.
I think that goes a little bit with disillusionment, though. I mean, there are some cases where it's, no matter how much the happy love feeling, people in general need to look and say, this is just my hormones talking, and, you know, this is who I truly love. Getting over the idea of puppy love and going, this is going to be a permanent problem. Am I willing to deal with this? Is it going to be healthy for me to deal with this? Rather than just saying, but I love them.
Yeah, and the premarital counseling I do, it doesn't focus a whole lot on how much do you love this person. It's okay, who's going to pay the bills? Who's going to clean the house? How are the kids going to be raised? Do you spank? Do you not spank? Where are you going to send your kids to college? All that stuff that nobody ever thinks about because we're in love, you know, that kind of thing. They don't see the practical aspects, and that's where all the marriages fall apart, especially two big things that marriages fall apart from, finances and sex.
And being in love won't pay the mortgage.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And sometimes you're just young and you're foolish and you shouldn't have gotten married to begin with, which is why I don't think there should be a really heavy penalty for divorce. I got married young to someone who was a good friend. And about a year later, we realized that we didn't really want to be married to each other. And that marriage just didn't work for us. And so we ended up having an amicable divorce. So, you know, along with, you know, marriage being forever and everything, I think there also should be the idea that, you know, you should support people who do come to the realization of, oh, we kind of made a mistake, didn't we? And you know, choose to amicably, you know, end that.
I think that, like, going off of all of this, there's a thought running in my head that the more romantic movies I see, the more it has this romanticized idea of, like, the guy cheats on her and gets some other girl pregnant and she's really mad, but then he gets her a teddy bear and they get married and it's okay.
And then she stabs him and cuts off his penis.
Right?
And then she's later boxed. Figure skater.
Oh, Lord.
You know, like, you can publicly humiliate somebody, but it'll be okay as long as you say you're sorry and you think they're pretty. Like, that is the most ridiculous. I hate romance novels and these romantic comedies are like, it doesn't matter what you do, everything will work out because of love.
And that whole idea of I love you, I can't live without you, all that kind of stuff, that is the that is not a healthy relationship. If somebody else is go ahead.
Well, the one person I know thinks that the best marriage is the second one, that the first marriage was just trying it out to see what marriage feels like, and if they can't do married, then they don't go for a second one, but if the first one is a trial run which crashed and burned, then they know what to expect and how marriage changes them, and so they go for it again with the knowledge of what they're getting into this time. And the best marriage is the second one.
And some people like Elizabeth Taylor never learn that.
Well, no, that's true.
Well, I mean, one thing that you know concerns me as a pagan is the metaphysical ramifications, you know, the theological ramifications, whatever you want to call it, of getting married and getting divorced. I mean, you know, getting handfasted was one hell of an experience. That's not like any other ritual by any stretch of the imagination. I mean, you establish a permanent bond with that person. And yeah. that's definitely very enlightening.
Here's a question. There's all various gods of love and harmony. Is there a god of divorce?
Yes.
Yeah. Weren't you the one who told me about that?
No, I told you about the Oh God of Hangovers.
Okay.
I love that book.
It's an awesome book. It really is. Like everybody who's read it's all like giggling. And everybody else is like, what the hell?
Handbook includes one of... And it's just about my all-time favorite quote. And the quote is, humanity is where the falling angel meets the rising ape. I love that.
Death gets all the good lines in that book.
Yeah,
he does. Oh, yeah. Okay, now I know what you guys are talking about.
We're back on Discworld.
Well, you know, to go back to what Amber was saying about, you know, one person being your all and your everything and not being able to live without that person. While you know, that idea wasn't exactly new among the ancients, it was really in the, I believe it was the late 1300s, the 1400s. No, earlier than that, because I think it actually started with Eleanor of Aquitaine's court back in like 1100 or something, is the troubadour tradition, which a lot of people have written about as being, you know, sort of goddess worship in disguise. But the troubadour tradition was where poets basically got paid to extol the virtues of either specific women or this ambiguous every woman who was their all and their everything and who they couldn't live without. And the troubadour tradition sort of fell over into folklore and into stories. And it's thanks to the troubadour tradition we have stories like Tristan and Isolde, where people go through, you know, they fall in love by really kind of shady means. And then they go through all of this crap because, you know, they are each other's one and everything. And I've always found it really interesting. And Irish mythology, the story of Deirdre, I believe it was Deirdre. Somebody correct me if I'm wrong, but I'm going to go with this anyways. So Deirdre was married to a man. She decided she didn't like him anymore. She put one of his warriors under gaze to her. And I may have pronounced that wrong. Sorry. And they ran off. And he had to protect her, and they went all over the countryside, and they lived in the woods, and it was very Robin Hood and Marian. And even though that sounds like a story where, you know, she decided he was her all and everything, it wasn't. It was sort of tumultuous. And then at the end, she ends up going back to her husband. And that's how, you know, pagan stories about love tend to be like that. They tend to be very complicated. Like, you know, Helen of Troy, that sounds awesome, but if I'm right, she ends up going back to her husband in the end. So, the idea of that very simplistic, you know, we're swans, we're mated forever, sort of springs from that tradition which developed within Christian culture. And I completely lost the point that I was getting to. I'm glad I got that out.
A good point.
Seriously, I'm not firing on all cylinders tonight. Sorry.
But you do make a very good point, though. I mean, that if you do look at the culture behind the multiple cultures involved in pagan faiths and indigenous faiths, that you find that the stories are complex. They are convoluted. They're all over the place. The relationships are complex, convoluted, all over the place. It's a very pluralist way of being, and it is like you say, you know, it's we sit here and say, hey, things are not simple, and I think that's the most simplistic way of saying that, you know, versus what a lot of the neo-pagan community grew up in, which has been pounded into their head that no, it is that simple to, you know, chop off your... Okay, I don't want to use that analogy. That's not a good analogy.
yeah, I noticed you're talking about thanks. Chopping things off a
chop
lot
off
tonight.
Kelly Mays.
Kelly Mays.
Lamika, is your real name Bobbitt?
Hey.
She sure likes shopping.
Yeah.
But how would the myths have changed, I wonder, if Arthur and Lancelot and Guinevere had become a triad polyamorous marriage?
What if they had? We don't really know.
Well, I know it's completely hypothetical, but if they had, then would the common Christian conservative contemporary, that's far too many C's in a row, view have changed on one man and one woman? You know?
No.
You know, I don't think so. Well, I don't think so, because originally, in the earliest myths about Arthur, he is actually referred to by the church as the enemy of God. His myth wasn't Christianized until much, much later, and it was heavily rewritten. So, right. No, I think all the awesome pagan stuff, I think, was just sort of destined to be rewritten or sanitized or pushed out of sight.
They would use it as an example. They would, you know, conservative Christians, if the story of Arthur had been that triad, it would have ended up becoming an example of failure and why it doesn't work and it destroys society and look what happened. You know, so it would ultimately backfire either way, because conservative whatever the hell are looking for. They're looking for the answers, but not really, because they're providing their own answers. So it's going to backfire either way. You know what I mean?
And they want as examples of what's wrong to prove that what they have is right, even though they can't really provide an example of what's right. They just know that it's not that other thing.
You know, there actually is a good example of, I don't know if you would categorize it as polyamorous, but it sort of fits the definition. I know I'm completely messing this up, but I think it's in the Ulster cycle of Irish mythology. Queen Maeve had a husband that she made her demands very clear that she wanted a husband without jealousy. She did not want to be fettered in any way by her marriage. She just wanted it to bring her even more honor. And so she made her demands pretty clear. And a lot of the things that I have read about her, people seem to take her demands for her marriage, for a husband without meanness or jealousy. Well, meanness actually had to do with finances, but for a husband without jealousy, is that she went into that marriage with it being an open relationship.
Yeah, and that gets into the political aspects of it too. The royalty versus the what does it call it? Courtly love. I don't think they called it that back then, but there's political marriages, and then there's marriages for love, and she was having it both ways there.
Yeah.
Well, the definition, not the definition, but the not necessarily the definition, but the use and practical application surrounding marriage has shifted so many times in so many different ways because of the variation within cultures and time periods and faiths and all that's going on, that in the end, it what really ends up showing, you know, and we talk about it here, but the ultimate reality is none of us can or do have any say on somebody else's marriage. And even the government one of the biggest Holy Mother Church in Rome does not have the authority to tell you otherwise. You may die in the process.
Yeah, you may get to, I was going to say, yeah.
Your ass may sit in jail for the rest of your life or get a bullet in the bread, in the head. But, you know, they don't have that power that you think that they do.
Yeah, that, I think that comes down to, okay, two or more people love each other and want to commit their lives to each other. What does marriage add to that, or is that marriage? And I think that's basically what it all comes down to.
You know, just to backtrack a little bit, most of the especially the goddesses that relate to love, that love was their domain, were not monogamous at all.
Yeah.
And
if you have to marry a lame blacksmith.
Well, hey, now wait a second here. I'm a devotee of the business, I have my own version of that story, which I will go into here right now. But if you look at that story just on the surface, Aphrodite did have two lovers. She had Hephaestus and she had Ares.
Yes.
But you also have to remember that Hephaestus actually had another wife, Aglaia, the youngest of the Graces. He married her, he had four children by her, and he tried really hard to get it on with Athena. And the only person out of, you know, his entire life that he ever tried to get rid of, that he tried to divorce, was Aphrodite. Yeah, that's because they just, the gods thought it was funny.
Yeah. And of course, Zeus.
Anytime they find it funny, you're just screwed. because in classical mythology, there's actually a lot of examples of polyamory. I mean, there's no reason to not believe that Zeus and Hera were actually quite... quite happy together, because I may be wrong again, and my brain's like pea soup, but most of the references to Hera just being a really, well, jealous bitch come from Homer, I think. So there's no reason to think that prior to Homer that anyone had this idea that Hera had actually an issue with Zeus being Zeus. I like Vera in the background.
Well, going back to the Arthur thing for a minute, one of the things I think Dave mentioned it earlier about the metaphysical ramifications of divorce, going back to the sovereignty that the land and the king are one. And the king is wed to the land, and if something happens to that relationship, then the entire land suffers for it. I'm wondering what everybody thinks about what the metaphysical ramifications are for a divorcing couple.
Well, someone once told me that anytime you split from someone, if you're intentionally splitting from them, that you're cutting karmic ties. And they told me that was like cutting a stretched rubber band, and both ends felt the backlash. I think that's the reason divorce is so traumatic. Even when it's amicable, mine was amicable, and it was still a traumatic thing in my life. Because, you know, I had ended something, and I had felt that I had failed at something, and I felt, I didn't hate my husband, ex-husband, but, you know, it didn't work out, and, you know, you feel like, you know, you've hurt the other person, and even when it's amicable, you're still ending something that had a lot of meaning and value for you. And that happens, I think, anytime you're in a relationship. If you decide to stop speaking to a family member, there's metaphysical ramifications for that. I recently got into a discussion with someone about the whole idea of banishing someone from like your coven, and I thought that was ridiculous and unnecessarily harmful to metaphysically pick someone up and kick them out into the street. That neither that person nor the group needs those negative, that negative backlash from just, you know, severing the ties that have been made.
I think it's necessary, though. I mean, to metaphysically dropkick somebody out of your coven is necessary. If that person has warranted being cut off, then isn't that just being practical about the situation? That that's like saying, I don't want this roommate living here, I've told them they have to leave, but I'm gonna let them stay here. Really, I mean, it's like you've got to separate that from you.
No, I agree with you on that. I wasn't clear. It's the idea of the ritual and you know, whatever perspective. To me, divorce is a ritual. Just as the marriage was a ritual, the divorce was a ritual. There was a process I had to go through. There was paperwork I had to fill out. There was my own intent that I had to be certain of. The other person involved, I had to be certain of his intent. And I had to go through, you know, the ritualized process of going in front of the judge. And, you know, the judge had his ritualized questions that he had to ask me. And, you know, so there was formality to the process. So it was literally a severing ritual. So I think there's a difference, though, between asking someone to leave and ritually banishing them.
No, I understood what you meant. I still stand by what I said. If you go through all these, you know, when we're talking about marriage, you know, you talked about how, yes, you know, it is that ritual you have to go through if it's a divorce. If you have this person, your coven is supposed to be your family. You know, these men or women are supposed to be lifelong with you. And if they have to be removed, I mean, it's certainly something that you don't want to be doing habitually, because then there's something just wrong with your coven. But, you know, they have to be removed.
Like hell, every time we kick a permanent host off this show, there is that little ritualized component, and then we move on.
Yeah.
The coven,
go ahead, Miles.
The coven acknowledges that people do grow and change, and that if a person, let's say, moves away for whatever reason, he can't take the entire coven with him. So if a person moves away, let's say, to the other side of the country, then the coven has an amicable releasing of the one coven member. Whereas in a committed relationship with the intention of being lifelong, then everyone would agree on having to move or not, and would do it together.
I'm wondering about the lifelong too. If that's a if that's a pagan thing, or if that's something that came from Christianity or Judeo-Christianity or something like that, the whole lifelong commitment. It sounds good as an ideal, but very few people are actually able to do it. And I'm wondering if that is something that is considered pagan. I haven't been able to find any references to it in any of the older mythologies, and I was just wondering if anybody...
If you have that as an ideal, then the whole, even though I'm Wiccan, I hate the Wiccan ideal of, well, so long as the love lasts. So as soon as we get our first argument, okay, we can dissolve the marriage. No big deal. Like, I think that is wrong.
No, well, you know, lifelong is very pagan. Judeo-Christians, whatever they may think, they have the warrant, you know, they have the bill on everything. They don't. Paganism, if anything, has the card on everything. Lifelong, that's very pagan.
The Romans actually had two different forms of marriage that you could go through. One was a marriage that you could change your mind and get divorced from. The other form of marriage was one that was lifelong, and that there was just no way you could get out of that marriage. So yeah. But you know, Dave, that whole as long as love shall last, I find it funny that some of the people who have become most famous for that phrase have stretched it way beyond its meaning. The Wiccan woman, I cannot remember her name, who married Jim Morrison, and they were handfasted for as long as love shall last. He left her, and then he died, and she's still going around calling herself Mrs. Morrison.
I know in a lot of, well, I'm not going to say a lot because there's too many of them. In some native tribes, it was, you were married. In some of them, the women held it. So if the men did something that they weren't happy with, they just took the red blanket down and you took your belongings and that was it. No questions asked, marriage nullified, goodbye. But at the same time, you look at, there are some of them that had, when you got married, That was your partner. You don't look at other people. You don't accept other people because you have a partner, and don't, you know, don't disrespect your family like that. So back then, there was different views even among tribes. So it's not necessarily Christian per se, because even back then there was both.
Yeah.
Yeah. And go ahead.
Oh, well, I was just going to say that, you know, I know among the Cherokee that divorce was just you came home and your wife had put all your belongings outside of the tent, and that meant you were divorced. It was like that simple. She just had to kick you out, and that was it.
Yep.
So I had a Cherokee divorce the first time. Okay.
You know, I'm so glad I've never been married now. I was actually starting to regret that a little bit the other day, and this has been... Yeah. It's a little bit blue for me, but this has been very therapeutic.
Going back on the idea of metaphysical ramifications of divorce real quick, I think that with the marriage being a ceremony, like a religious, or not let's say religious, let's just go with spiritual, because really if you're bonding with another person, that is a very spiritual experience. You're promising to share your whole existence with them. That's a big ritual, whether it's with a priest, whether it's a JP, whether it's, you know, whatever. It's with that other person. When it comes to divorce, even if that person is abusive, that is cutting away a part of what you have accepted as yourself. Even on a completely mundane level, if you have... some sort of abscess inside and you go to have it removed, the surgery is going to be painful, even though it is for your benefit and you are removing something that is malignant. It's not a pleasant experience. I think that divorce needs to have that backlash, whether you're getting rid of somebody that's a bad influence on you or whether you guys just aren't working out and it's time to call it quits. Because without that backlash, without that ramification, I think it lessens the respect that that kind of partnership should demand.
No, I totally agree. I mean, my marriage didn't make me more cautious about the idea of getting married again, but my divorce did. It was a grieving period, and it was a mourning period for what my hopes and dreams had been that were no longer, and it was a really a chance to reevaluate who I was and how I felt about things and get a better grip on, you know, what I actually wanted for my future. So I think having that backlash and having that sort of mourning period is important, and I know people who refuse to go through that. They before their divorce papers are even signed, they're out there dating people and talking about moving in with people, and I worry about that, especially if they're someone who's close to me, because I feel like they haven't given themselves enough time to process what they've gone through and to really understand what happens and what that means for them and what they need for their future.
How supportive were your pagan friends of your divorce process? Not of the divorce itself, but of the process that you went through during the grief period, if you will.
Oh, I was a solitary. So my online friends were supportive, but not in a direct way. My Christian friends were very shocked and upset and disturbed about it. They were surprised that for people who got along as well as we did, that we chose to end it. Because their idea was that unless someone's cheating on someone else or someone's an alcoholic or some other really like horrible, dreadful thing that, you know, and unless people are like screaming at each other in the rain, that people shouldn't get divorced. You know, but it turned out to be a good thing because, you know, my husband and I wanted children
And luckily we didn't have them, so we made the decision to split before we had children, and would have that binding influence that would not have made things nearly so amicable.
Here's a question. This kind of pertains to what we're talking about, bringing metaphysical stuff into it. Now, Bear and I follow completely separate paths, but we've known each other all our lives. We're 21 now. We've known each other since we were 6, and we're going to get married. So, just kind of wondering what you guys think, and I don't know, what is the general thought process with two different faiths kind of coming together? We were even trying to talk about wedding plans, and even the separate faiths bring problems into ceremonies and stuff like that.
This coming April, I'm officiating a hand fasting between a Wiccan and a Christian. And a Wiccan has asked me to use all the traditional Wiccan hand fasting procedure, but to refer to the divinity over seeing it as God singular, no specific names of gods given. And for the question of two faiths in a union of marriage, I think the question would be, do the two faiths individually have any problem with marrying outside the faith? Do you have any problem with marrying someone who is, of course you don't obviously, not a member of your faith? Would your families have issue with you marrying someone who is outside your faith? Would the gods be okay with it?
Well, those are some of the questions that we've had to go through with all of it. I don't know if our situation was different if we could feel the same way. Because, like I say, we've grown up together, you know. We've never really... We've known each other our entire lives. Our spirituality hasn't necessarily been a factor in us coming together. You know, if per se either one of us was meeting the other just on the street and starting a relationship, the answers to the questions might be a little different, you know.
Go ahead. Oh. Well, I was just going to say, you know, my husband was not interested in religion. He thought that my paganism was just sort of like geek cred, you know, and like it like added to my whole Dungeons and Dragons persona. That was sort of his perspective on it, and I obviously didn't feel that way. I felt very strongly about it, and you know, we had the whole conversation about, you know, well, if we have kids, you know, I felt strongly that they needed to be really raised in a religious tradition. And so we talked about what that might be, since, you know, he came from he considered himself nominally Christian, and I didn't. And that was something that we sort of struggled over. And then later I dated guys who were Christian, and I dated guys who were Jewish, and I dated guys who were from different pagan paths. And I have actually come to the realization that, you know, the problem is if you're pagan, the problem for me is that people, although they, even if they personally think your religion is cool, they tend to want you back inside the box, so that they're not embarrassed by friends or family. And so I think the real issue isn't so much if you can solve the whole children issue, if you plan to have children, if that's not an issue, and if you can solve the whole, is this person comfortable with letting their family and friends know about your faith, you know, I don't think it should have a real huge emphasis on whether or not you get married. If you're, if the two of you are okay with each other's path, and you love each other and you respect each other and so forth, I don't think it should be an issue. I think the problem is when it comes up to the point that you know, you want to raise children very differently, or someone wants you to, you know, in paganism, you know, get back in the broom closet when their family comes around. That's
yeah.
sort of a serious, ongoing, lifelong issue.
Mm-hmm. Which means that in a multi-faith relationship, we have to answer to three questions then. We have to ask if it's okay with the gods and the laws and also the in-laws.
Yeah.
We both have in-laws that, aren't huge fans necessarily of what we follow, so we know that they're not going to like what the other one follows, but that's okay. We've kind of said we really don't care. Be happy for us. Get over it.
I've seen that.
More than just that. I mean, when you're in a relationship with somebody who's not of the same faith, it's also the element of culture. Because when you're a neo-pagan and you're coming into Wicca or Asatru or what have you, there's not yet a genuine buildup of contemporary culture. And so it's a little bit easier to divorce your faith from the practical everyday situations. Whereas if you go into an interfaith relationship with a pagan who had, let's say, you know, for example, Amber or myself, who we come from a culture and a faith that are not, you cannot divorce it because it's your heritage. You are put in a very difficult situation sometimes. And overcoming that, you know, it's almost like we talked about, you know, the levels of maturity when it comes to what's considered normal marriage, one person, one man, one woman, to polyamory. And we said, you know, I think somebody in the chat room had said that polyamory is the grad student of or the graduate level work of marriage versus the bachelor's, which I guess is the one person or one man, one woman. And you add more and more complications, and it's very difficult.
Once you're initiated into the first degree of marriage, there are two more to go through.
So three strikes and you're out. Yeah, the third degree is what the lawyer gives you in divorce court.
Very good.
I did have a very dear friend of mine who was in a long-term relationship with another pagan. She was Baptist, and for the most part, things worked very, very well. I mean, his family came from a long line of having that in their family, so he wasn't about to give up anything. She was okay with it. She was very open-minded, but there were problems when it came a little bit to not understanding why sometimes he had to be alone, or why things had to go this way, because in her faith practices they work this way and you can do them in groups, and what's the problem? Why can't you? You're just being stubborn. They ended up not staying together, but more because he sucked at life than religious problems. But I think if they would have stayed together, the religious problems would have worked themselves out. The problem that I see, I think Star kind of mentioned it, if I remember right, is that it takes somebody respecting what you're doing and the fact that you're not going to leave it behind. Your spirit lies there. That's a part of who you are, and they're not going to change it. I personally don't have the time and energy to worry about explaining to somebody who is not pagan why I do tarot cards and why it is okay and why. So that's just something that isn't personally for me, but I have seen it work.
Or why you cannot divorce, you know, your faith from raising children. Yes. Why you can't divorce, you know, it's like living in a world of subtractions and trying to explain addition to somebody who doesn't even know that exists is also tiring.
Yeah. You know, and Amber makes a really good point. I mean, I, not so long ago, spent 3 hours on an airplane sitting next to an evangelical who was an absolutely awesome guy. Absolutely awesome guy. He's a friend of mine. I think the world of him. But he wanted me to explain paganism from scratch. And he had no frame of reference. And that's huge. It's like, because, I mean, if you imagine if someone has no frame of reference for Christianity, trying to sit down and explain that and all the nuances and everything. I mean, just trying to explain the Trinity to someone who has no frame of reference for Christianity could take you all day. It seriously could. And it's a lot of work being in an interfaith relationship, which is why I'm really not so certain I would want to do that ever again.
I mean, even with my mother, my sister, I mentioned on last episode that she has a pagan boyfriend, and my mother is coming to me with questions, and it's like, oh, I know she's accepting now, but it's just trying to explain to her, you know, well, what's a circle? Oh, I don't want to go over this. You know? And that's just my mother. This isn't even an intimate relationship.
Yeah, that's when you give them the required reading list and say, just call me in a couple of weeks if you have any questions.
Right.
Well, you know, I've attempted that with that required reading list before. That's normally subject to a lot of fail.
Yeah.
But you know, something that a friend of mine talked about not so long ago, and I think she made a really, really good point, is that if you get married and you convert to the other person's religion just because you're marrying them, that's really disrespectful to the religion. And I think that's an important thing to talk about in interfaith. There are a lot of people who are like, you know, they're not religious. They don't give a crap. So sure, I'll become Catholic so I can marry you. And that's just kind of like, you know, do you really want to drag this man who's going to be kind of half-heartedly like shuffling behind you to Mass every Sunday? That does not seem like a positive thing to me.
You know what? We actually see it a lot with the Native community that I don't know if so much with the guys, but the women will marry a Native because they're like, oh, they're so pretty and they're so wonderful. But the whole idea, they like them being Native, but they don't like them being Native.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, no, and it's so weird. It's like, but that's weird stuff. You should go to church with me. And they're like, but yeah. I don't want to. I want to go to powwow. And they're like, you shouldn't do that anymore.
Yeah, the romanticized view of what's going on versus, you know, the reality of it where...
I have to admit that I tend to, for some weird reason, gravitate towards people who are into sci-fi and D&D and gaming, because I'm a little bit of a nerd at heart. And so, like, the pagan thing sounds, like, really, really cool sometimes to guys. They're like, oh, that is so cool. You're, like, pagan? Like, I read a book about that, and I saw something about that in this movie, and isn't Lisa Simpson Wiccan? And, you know, it's all cool. And then they're like, oh, wait, you're religious? Yeah. Like, they didn't expect that you'd actually be religious because you said that you practice religion.
Paganism is something you experiment with in college, not something you're serious about. Come on.
Yeah, it's like being bi, you know. Eventually you make a choice.
It's a phase.
Oh, yeah. Uh-huh.
Yeah. That was totally a jab at you, Lamika. I'm sorry.
Oh, I caught it. That's why I put down my fork and was like, I'm going to punch her.
I know. If you could have stabbed me with a fork from Hawaii, you would have.
Oh, yeah. I've got mega powers. But you make a point, though, you know? People think that you're going to snap out of being you. You know, that's insanity. That's just sheer freaking insanity.
One of my sisters thinks I've been going through a phase for over a decade now.
Nah.
Better you than me.
Long phase.
I think one of the things, too, about that whole different faiths thing is, as long as you're focusing on, I mean, to me, any religion or spiritual path, whatever you want to call it, should be about improving yourself. And when you start turning around and saying, I'm going to improve you now, then you've ceased to have a productive religion or spiritual path. And I think that if two people are going to come together and enjoy and love each other, then as long as they're focusing on allowing their religion or their spiritual path to improve themselves, and I don't see any problems with it, but if they start trying to improve each other, yeah, like, you need to start going to church, you need to go to powwow, or you need to come to circle tonight, then I think that's when all the problems start happening.
We're pretty lucky. We're Ossetru and Kemetic, Baron, myself, respectively, and we refuse to change. We are way too bullheaded. I will not change who I am for anyone but myself, and he feels the same way. So, and I think we're actually, in terms of the whole children thing, y'all kind of barely touched on that. Our parents, well, at least mine, they never told me what to be. Yeah, if I asked them, there was a little bit of emphasis on Christianity. That's great. That's fine. But I did get the chance to do whatever I wanted to do. And I wasn't necessarily respected for it, but I wasn't stopped from it. So I don't know. I think that's how my personal view of raising children will be, is I will teach my children anything they ask me, but I will not enforce anything.
And I think, you know, some of... Go ahead, Lamika.
Just really quick. When we talk about these interfaith issues, most of us will reference, you know, paganism and something else. But, you know, Amanda, you're a very good example of the future. Pretty soon, when we talk about interfaith issues, it's going to be, well, because, you know, this guy I'm dating, he's Asatrar, but I'm a Wiccan. You know? I mean, right now, we're kind of enjoying that umbrella of, excuse me, you're a Kemetic and you're a Gardnerian Wiccan, and it'll be okay because we're still pagans, you know? Then again, who knows? Maybe interfaith issues don't really exist in paganism.
I can see that happening. I can totally see, like, Dear Abby. So, I'm a druid, and my husband's a gardenerian, and to be honest, I'm not really comfortable with him going out in the middle of the night and getting naked with a bunch of other people. What do you suggest we do? Well, you know, first, lonely in Las Vegas.
Nice.
First, I say we put a camera up on Dear Abby.
Paganism, I think, embraces all these different facets of, like, Asatru and Wicca and Hermetic and all these various things, because we're all just little fish so far who see collective unity in the big sea, and the big fish right now, of course, is Christianity, and it has tried to tamp all of us out at various times, and so we are collectively one average highest group, but all the individual parts of it are very little. As we evolve and grow, I think we'll become more independent as specific pagan paths, and so in 500 years, let's say, then the question of Asatru versus Hermetic might be a big deal, but as is today, it's all just two kids in the same sandbox. It'll grow later on, I think.
I think some of the interfaith goes with, kind of going backwards a bit, when Miles had brought up, what are your gods, you know, are your gods okay with it? There is some degree where people don't put not enough realistic views on the deities. So they're like, oh, they're deities. They'll be okay with anything because they're pagan and I'm pagan and I love everyone. So, but I know in my dealings with the comedic side of things that there are definite sections where they don't really care for. They don't want to deal with those deities. They don't like when I deal with those deities. And if I dealt with somebody who was part of that, I'm pretty sure I would get beaten senseless. So,
who are you referring to, Sekhmet?
Maybe.
There's a question. You probably wouldn't jive anyways. Oops, sorry, Moss.
That's okay. There's a question that comes up now and then about would entities of different pantheons be okay in the same ritual invocation, like. Can you invoke, let's say, Odin and Pele together? Would they be okay with that? Because for the time of that ritual, you are effectively, I think, marrying them as the lord and lady in the ritual.
Well, that's going through through Wiccan channels, and while it can be it can be where pagans generally meet. It's not necessary. Like, yeah. The whole lord and lady is, I respect the Wiccan belief system. I'm not saying anything against it. But if I treated my gods like a Wiccan treat the average, the stereotypical, I'm not talking Dave Wiccan, I'm talking Fluffy Bunny Wiccan. If I treated Odin like that, knowing
you would
what
get
I
bitch slapped.
Odin would, yeah, I would get my handed to me.
You do not tell a god to come to your circle. You do not tell a god to come to your circle.
You invite.
The Barrett, don't invite. You know that they're all the same? They look all the same to me.
Yeah, and they all just love you. Love you
to
death.
I think it all be interchanged for the Joker, right?
Twitch.
There's a blog I wrote recently called Is Wicca Becoming a Plug and Play Religion?
Yes, it is. I'm sorry, Dave.
You know, actually, I think, and maybe it's just my own personal, I want this to be so I am saying it is so until it is so. But I think Wicca might actually have a tide rolling in the other direction because I think people really are getting tired of the whole plug and play nonsense. And
No, we're sick and tired of our religion being flooded with newbies. Okay, being newbie is okay, but you've been a newbie for 5 years now. This is not cool.
Well, and just people who, you know, they, yeah. So that's my perspective, but then I have a vested interest in my being right on that.
I got a certain view when it comes to religion and being a newbie. You study for a while.
Yeah.
Preferably in private. I know. I know it sounds a little bit like the broom clause, which is not entirely a bad thing. You study in private. No, learn how to open your mouth without stupid falling out. Thank you for that, Sam Brandon. I love it, by the way.
Well, you know, actually, I have a little bit of a different perspective on that. I think that people, not only should they research on their own and study on their own, but I think that it should be perfectly acceptable for someone to make up a very silly screen name and to use that screen name to interact with people on forums and get a feel of interacting with the pagan community. And then once you get to the point where you know enough that you can carry on an intelligent conversation, you change your screen name. That the sins of the former screen name, that your newbiness sin does not carry on.
But hey, if you think about it, that is an actual, you know, we make jokes about it, but that is a modern day version of what, you know, many, at least Pacific pagan societies would have. You, when you're born, you're given your child name. When you're an adult, you choose your name. You know what I mean? It's a good thing. Yeah.
Right. Oberon's changed his name 3 times, and he mentioned once that a person is allowed to change his magical name 3 times in his life.
Because that's how many times he's changed his?
Yes.
Okay.
He has. That's true.
Wait for it to come out as 7.
But it's your... It was a thought that just left my head as I reached for it. If you are a newbie pagan and you try this god and you try that god and you try this pagan ritual format and you try that one, you bounce around here and there and there and there, eventually, I'd like to think, you will settle down with one tradition or one aspect of paganism or one god and become more committed to that one path or that one deity or that one enchera, so that as you mature as a pagan, you will then become more centered in yourself and more able to make defined and intensive choices and know who you are and know what you want out of paganism and what you want to put into your faith. And so there it becomes like a marriage, like a long-term commitment of faith. I don't know if sex applies there. A really bad pun referring to know thyself in the biblical sense comes to mind, and I'm not going to mention that. But I think that marriage and faith really can best be defined by having a mature perspective on them. I don't think you should be allowed to wed until you're at least 25, because you don't really know who you are yet. If you wait until 35, then you've narrowed it down to knowing who you are and what you're about, and you won't go messing up juvenile marriages. But that's just me.
I appreciate that Miles brought it back to the topic at hand. And so I wanted to try not to derail it again in my comment. But
I call it a falling star.
So, when you're going from one religion to another, you're changing extremely radically different worldviews. And you have to give yourself space and time for that to happen, because it is a process and it does take time. And so in the same way, though, if you're going from being someone who is single to wanting to be in a relationship or in a marriage or something, that's another thing where you have to take time to explore that and to understand that and to make that transition, because it is a huge transition to go from being completely single, not having to be dependent on anyone or answering to anyone, and then, suddenly there's this other person in the house who wants you to pick up their prescription.
I just want to talk on the point of age limits, like can't until 25, can't until 35. I disagree on that, because there's a lot of people that are 40 plus that don't have the maturity of a 5-year-old. You can't go with age, at least if you're talking legally, because it all depends on maturity level.
And it's not our fault if we're only a certain age, you know?
Amanda, when do you plan to wed, if I may ask?
Oh,
22.
At age 22.
Next year.
Okay. Only reason I asked. I've been
21. I've been 21. I'm
like, what? Only reason I ask is that I think, of course, this is me talking and I'm not you and I'm very possibly dead wrong, is that adolescents don't really know who they are yet until their hormones have quit bouncing all over the place. And that's why I don't think you should wed at 15, 16, 17. Do you think that, and of course you'll say yes, you will be ready to wed at 22. You'll have known each other by now for 16 years, I think, if my math is right, which is good. That's a long time to get acquainted all the way through childhood. Do you think, ready as individuals to commit to a relationship of this magnitude across faiths?
If you're talking personally, we've had many, many, many a conversation about it. Now, I will flip it and I will agree with you that the average person who does not know a person for very long, and the average person who may have only known someone for a year and they're 23 and they want to get married, or you could even make a joke about it and say all these celebrities that are getting married at like 22, 23, something like that, you're very right. They don't know each other. But if you... Like, I have spent hours and hours and hours discussing personal problems I might have with certain faiths. I actually wanted to say something you were talking about, newbie, with all the newbie stuff. My personal view on learning religion is go back to the most original documents you can possibly find and find out what it really is about. So, we've spent so much time learning on who we are that I do think that we're ready. And if we aren't, we're not going to get too much closer than we are.
That's true. I think that you really do have a point, though, Miles. I've seen, you know, Amanda, you and I have had long, long discussions, and I really feel comfortable saying that, yeah, you are very mature individual, and you definitely have very solid ideas all of your own. But I do agree with Miles that, the, you know, most people, you really don't get to have an idea of who you are until the hormones settle down. Because hormones do so much that most people don't realize. I mean, when you look back on your teenage years and you look at the people that you said, oh my God, I can never live without them. You look back and go, oh my God, how did I ever feel that way? That was absolutely ridiculous.
Oh, yeah.
That's true.
You know, as a teenager, I was a conservative Christian. I was a fundamentalist. And I was raised to believe that it was my job to marry a godly man and to have chillins. And if you had asked me, when I was 14, if I thought I was ready for marriage, I would have told you yes. I would have told you yes all the way up until I was like 16 or 17. So there's the whole thing of people feeling like they're ready, without they're actually being ready. I mean, looking back, obviously that was ridiculous. There was no way that I was ready. I wasn't ready at 20 to be married, but I did it anyways.
We're also forgetting about.
I was just going to say that the research shows that your brain isn't fully developed until your early 20s, and the part that develops last is the part that makes good judgment and emotional decisions.
Yeah,
according to things now. But, I mean, just 100 years ago, you know, people, before this quote-unquote modern age, people were getting married at 13, 14, 15, 16, you know?
Living till maybe 30.
Yeah, and living till maybe 30. So, we can't exactly say that
Oh, yes. I mean, like, I do agree that, yeah, whoa, there really needs to be an age cap on that. And there's a reason why there's, you know, consent ages. But at the same time, you know, who am I to say that, let's say this hypothetical star, what if, you know, in some parallel universe, star is like, you know, praising Jesus and she got married at 15, you know, and she popped out like 7 kids. And still going. That works for that parallel, you know, star, but...
But yeah, but knowing myself at that age, knowing who I was at that time...
Yeah, but my
I can say that, I can say that that would have actually been... Had I gotten married at that age, that would have been an abusive situation because I hadn't finished growing. And even if I had remained Christian... And, you know, there's always that possibility that I could have that I don't think so. But there's that possibility that just because I remained Christian and everything doesn't mean that I would have been ready for that for that commitment. I think I would have definitely felt very trapped.
I think on just the psychological development from what I understand it, you know, just like Star was saying, it would be an abusive situation. You know, we don't have an accurate understanding of the mental growth of people when they were marrying at 13 and 15, 100 years ago. Why? Because they didn't do the studies like we're doing now to the depths that we're doing now.
True, but they're also not the same people.
Well, I just want to say something really quick, and I'm sorry. But you also have to remember that the people who were getting married that young were women marrying older men, generally. Mm-hmm. Like literally, like 99% of the time. So it wasn't... I can't really say so much that consent was so much a part of that.
And yeah, I mean, I'm just saying, like, that if we're talking about these studies, we're talking about completely different groups of people. I mean, you talk about the average 14-year-old now, and honestly, they suck at life. They're utterly useless. They're leeches to their parents. And that's considered okay. Whereas, you know, 100 years ago, whether you're looking at Europe or many other societies that are not Judeo-Christian or societies who are Judeo-Christian, if you were a leech to your parents, even at the age of 8, you couldn't do it because it put your family in jeopardy.
See, no, I'm going to definitely disagree with that because I was a very different kid. I had to grow up and mature, but I still didn't hit... Everything still changed right along with what everything's saying, and that, you know, even though I was mature for my age, that... No, there were definitely still changes going on that I had no control over. Even though I was intellectually more mature, there was still so much basing on the hormones and just the way things develop. So even taking that into account, but my point was based on you're looking at the brain develops by patterns. Everything real deals with patterns. So if you have somebody that is having sexual relations at a young age, especially if it's a girl with an older guy, that sets up so many patterns. Not just, I have to be okay with the relationship. It's, you know, there's the age difference between father and husband and how you're supposed to obey that may not be even at the forefront. So whether or not it's pagan or Christian or anything, I think more of it deals with making sure the child has developed enough to be able to handle themselves as an individual. And I don't think that can happen until the person's done developing.
Well, yeah, and I'm not disagreeing with that. I'm just saying that you and somebody else are two completely different people. And we can look at all, we can do these studies all we want, but surveying 100, 1,000, even 100,000 people is not the 7 billion on the planet. You know what I mean?
if I may for a minute.
Nope, we stopped on, we stepped on you a whole bunch of times.
Sorry, Joe.
Let's look at this from a practical moment, practical for a few moments. 100 years ago, or a couple hundred years ago, you had a lifespan of maybe 30 years. Today, assuming you take shit care of yourself, and yes, I did intentionally swear there, you could easily look at 50 years. Assuming you take reasonable care of yourself, 60 or 70. Back then, you had a large family structure. And this is going back to the coven thing. Back then, if you wanted a divorce, you might not just be divorcing your husband. It's almost like excommunication. You might not just be divorcing your wife, okay? You had a large family structure. There's a lot of accountability there. Today, we got little nuclear families. And as someone said earlier about plug and play religion, it's almost plug and play family.
The standard, I think, ideal of the big Italian family is mama and all the kids and the grandkids and the cousins and everyone else all under one roof, working as a village, pretty much. And so if a son marries a young lady who comes into the family as well, she becomes not just his wife, but a part of the entire active family dynamic. And so she then has to answer to everybody on all the various age levels. She's responsible for helping to change little babies in it, and they aren't hers, and taking of the older folks and all the rest of it. So it's more like a commune than a nuclear family. I'm also thinking of something Joe mentioned about life expectancy, in that in the Middle Ages, when the life expectancy was like 30 or 40 years, I once heard someone comment that all the big wars in Germany, or what it was called then, in France and Prussia and things, all those really happened because the kings and queens back then were teenagers having emotional temper tantrums. I'm sorry,
go ahead, Brian.
I was going to say something else that was not brought up was arranged marriages. I think it was Star Lamika brought up that right now 14-year-olds are a burden, basically a burden on their parents, and that's okay, and we accept that. Well, in a lot of different cultures, even nowadays, there's still arranged marriages going on for females, males of teenage years. Now, if you look at it that way, you're not marrying for love. You're not marrying because you want to spend the rest of your life with these people. You are being married for whatever reason, whether it's a cultural thing, whether it's a political thing, royalty sort of thing. And the
because
whole
you were
idea,
told to.
Yeah. And you are no longer marrying out of love, and it doesn't matter if you are mature enough to handle it. You are now being turned over to somebody else to raise you, or for you to continue your growing, so on and so forth. And it sort of takes a lot of what we've discussed throughout the evening out of it. And also goes back to changing your religion and stuff. I mean, that's how Christianity took over most of Northern Europe, was through marriage, you know, marrying off these younger Christian nobles, or not even so nobles, to the pagan kings and rulers of the northern European areas, they in turn would bring their religion with them, and eventually, because of being busy doing whatever you had to do, the males would transfer their religion and their children's religion over to the wives, because, well, technically the wife had more time to do the religious thing. So that's sort of how most of Northern Europe became Christianized.
Right, and missionaries also focused on the wives, because Christianity's language tended to empower women who were in situations where they didn't feel like they were empowered. If I can backtrack just a second, Scurvy kind of made a good point about the whole plug-and-play family thing. And I completely forgot what the point I was going to make on that. But then there was another point that was really good on arranged marriage. The Orthodox Jewish community has actually found that to be a very healthy, productive part of their religious community. I actually watched a really good movie about it not so long ago. The idea really behind it isn't so much that you're forced to marry someone because your parents say so, but the idea is that your parents and your rabbi and the people who have known you your entire life participate in helping to find a mate for you. And that's sort of a very supportive thing. I think it's sort of admirable.
Yeah, and that's the other side of what people don't want to talk about when it comes to arranged marriage. It's like people act as though, well, because I met my wife or my husband when I was halfway slaughtered and drunk in a club, that it's somehow better than my parents or my loved ones saying, hey, maybe you should, you know, be with this person. You know, I mean, of course, there's always the forced ones as well.
The arranged marriage there is the elders of the marriage, I mean the elders of the family or the clan or whichever it is, choosing which partner would be the most beneficial for the clan as a whole. They don't really care if, oh, let's say Frank and the person they want his new bride to be, let's call her Beth, if Hank and Beth are completely incompatible, that's irrelevant, because Beth will bring good things into the clan and will strengthen the clan. In a way, it's like if we have a household of four dogs and we choose to get a fifth dog, we will choose one that won't fight with the other dogs. The fifth dog has no choice in the matter. We say, okay, you're coming home with us now. Bing, this is your new home. It's like an arranged family of dogs.
Somehow that can happen, you know, that can happen when it comes to arranged marriages. You know, it's not necessarily the original intent of it, but it does happen, you know.
And I think there was an article I read, I don't remember where or even how long ago, but it was talking about a woman's perspective on the arranged marriage, and she had mentioned that it was just a completely different cultural standpoint, because you're taught that, you know, like Star was mentioning, everybody who has known you for years is looking out for your best benefit, and also that you can learn love isn't something that you find half sloshed at a club. Love isn't something that you find at first sight. You can learn to love somebody, so they take a completely different perspective to love and relationships, and she thought that it was absolutely amazing, rather than this horrible thing that she was forced to endure.
Yeah, I think that's the difference between marrying who you love and loving who you marry. If with an arranged marriage, you love the person you marry instead of marrying who you love.
Mm-hmm.
I think I remembered the point I was going to make about what Scurvy said about plug and play family. So that I what I wonder is if this tendency to have easy come easy go relationships, both romantic and friendships, if part of that stems from, or at least in the pagan community, that so many of us have been rejected by our biological family, that we feel like because they were able to dismiss us so easily, that that family and relationships in and of themselves are impermanent. I remember when I was in elementary school. This is a horrible story. It says horrible things about me, but I'll tell it anyways. I thought because you changed grades that your friends were supposed to change each grade. And it wasn't that I was a mean kid, but I thought that's how things were done. I thought you were supposed to make new friends every year. And to the point that I remember one time I changed grades and someone I had been in class with in a previous grade wanted to hang out with me on at recess. And I was like, don't you want to go make friends in your new class? And I like shooed her away from me because I thought that's how things were supposed to be. So I'm wondering if the plug and play family thing is sort of learned behavior.
I think so.
Scurvy.
Yeah.
You want? Sorry. Could you go on to explain what exactly you meant by the plug-and-play family? Just your ideas. Because I've been thinking about it, but I didn't really know where you were going with it.
Quite simply, you find two people. They may or may not already have kids. You put them all together in a house. I could look on any dating site and find pages of single moms, if you're lucky, or even more pages of mothers that still have the X in their life, if you're not so lucky. But, and this is a case of, okay, you got your guy, girl, speaking contemporary society at the moment, more or less, gets together, you have your baggage, guess what? You got a plug and play family. I can't count the people. I know three or four people right now that are in a relationship raising two or three kids that aren't theirs. What the heck? I mean, yeah, I work with one. Great guy. I respect him greatly for it, but I mean, it's... He's got a plug-and-play family. Unfortunately, hasn't really attached to it. He's... How do I say this? He's not married to his plug-and-play family. And that's just... That begins creating all sorts of... I don't even have a word for this.
That sounds like a reality show in the making.
Well, I mean, he's committing a lot to something that can disappear in a heartbeat.
Yeah, and when he no longer, yeah, when he no longer fits the puzzle piece, he can be out of
yeah,
that.
Yeah, and this is family. As I said, it's plug and play.
You know, that makes me think about, you know, like dating sites and stuff tend to classify you as certain values as if you're. You're like you're an NES system, and you're trying to find another NES system that you're compatible with, and that's really all there is to it, you know, as long as you like weed out the Sony PlayStation and the Sega Genesis and the Xbox, as long as you can find a Nintendo system, you're good to go, and it just tends to reduce people to.
Profiling?
To components that, you know, you can plug into and, you know, everything's just supposed to magically fit as if we're electronic components.
You like cake and want kids? That's great, because I like cake and want kids. We should totally get married.
Totally.
Hey, let's expand this a little bit farther, and I meant to bring this up during the polygamy topic, but from the child's perspective, they already got it. Not all of them. But how many kids have two moms because dad divorced and remarried?
Yeah.
I did.
Yeah, that's what I was... Yeah, that's what I was saying earlier about we already have polyamory. We just don't call it that.
I have a friend who her mother and father got divorced. Her father got remarried and her mother moved back in. So she grew up with her mother and her stepmother in the same house in a polyamorous relationship.
Hey, if it works. I'm real big on results. But
she hasn't killed anyone yet.
Well, that's a positive.
But I think a lot of what makes this happen is we've cut down the cost. I mean, you get a divorce today, you're out what? Half your income? A chunk of your retirement? Maybe your house? I mean, yeah, that sounds like a lot, but I mean, in this culture, it's not really as much anymore, because you can go out, rent an apartment. I know, and I know plenty of people that have, especially two retirements, if you did an enlistment all the way through, they'll say, screw it, I'll just give her that one retirement, and I'll just keep on working, just so I don't have to deal with her anymore. And why? Because it's easier that way.